Okay, been having some troubles with my taping. The technology is not working so great, so I'm trying a workaround and see if it works. We're out here in the sunshine, California sunshine, probably the last nice day we'll have for quite some time. A winter pattern is coming in, and so we'll soak it in while we have it. Just trying natural light right now. So let's see if some of the glitches come out. But it's all good. Because the glitches are just the grace of God as well. I don't get upset if whatever happens, I feel it's all for the best, all for the best. And this is a great attitude to have in the world is no matter what happens, is to say this, take it like this is all for the best and keep riding the wave. So we are moving into the surfing the apocalypse time right now, starting I guess 21st of March or the 22nd, I haven't decided which. We're very close. And we're using this analogy here, a surfing analogy. And surfing captures the imagination of those who watch it. They say, wow, that looks like a lot of fun. So you're on this wave and you're surfing it, and you see in front of you, the whole wave is breaking in front of you, it's closing out, and you're going to wipe out. So you go up to the lip, the top of the wave, and you look out and up, out to the ocean. There's this gorgeous, beautiful, unbelievably beautiful wave, and you say, "Oh, that's the wave of my dreams." So what do? Do you kick out of the wave you're on, or to go towards that wave that's coming in, or do you continue with the wave you're on and wipe out into turmoil? To surf the apocalypse, we need to make that key decision. So we're out in the ocean, we're surfing. And we're on this wave. That's the situation everybody is in. We're using this analogy. We're all on this wave. And when we're looking at him, I say, oh my gosh, it looks like trouble ahead. What do I do? So we go to the top of the wave and we look back to the ocean. Is there any other alternative? We're saying, are there any alternatives? And lo and behold, we see this tremendous alternative. So we're right at that point. So surfing the apocalypse, we have to make the right decision. So what we say here is we say, wow. And this enables us to keep our poise enough to make the right decisions. So it's all about making that one key decision of blocking, getting out of the wave, blocking panic enough to recognize I need to get out of the wave that I'm on. And go to this new wave that's coming. And the only way to do that is to not panic. If we panic, we tend to stay with our old habits. And since we're so habituated to this wave that we're on right now, we're thinking, well, I just got to stay on this wave. And yet, if we do, we're going to just be massacred by the wave. So instead, we say, wow. Just wow. My decision is wow. My feelings are wow. What I'm going to do is wow. And so you feel your mind is not scattered. When you're able to just focus on one thought, one reaction, one plan, one everything, one definition, one equation, one everything, which is wow. So you say, I know, you don't panic. That blocks panic in the mind. You feel you're still jittery, but you're calm, you're composed, and you're in the now of the wow. You're in the now of the wow. Something's just floating, all this stuff floating up in the air. It's beautiful. We might even do an aerial off the lip, get up in the air. So we can take a peek what's behind this wave. And we have to decide which way we're going to turn our board when we come down. Are we going to turn it back to the ocean where this other wave's coming in? Are we going to turn it back onto the wave we're on? So it's a pretty easy decision, except when we panic. If we weren't panicking, we would easily decide, get out of the wave we're on, go to this one that's coming in. It would be no problem at all. But if we panic, we will stay with our habits. Okay, so to surf the apocalypse, you cannot panic. We cannot panic. We must not panic. It's interesting. There was this spider spun a web in front of this light that I have up here. And the problem was at night, the light attracted insects. And so the spider would get the insects because it had spun its web in front of the light. So finally, I cleaned the web out and said, "No more, spider, come on. This is not fair. You're using the light to ensnare." So, but I didn't kill the spider. I don't kill anything really. I try not to. Occasionally ants, so if there are too many ants, I say, "Wow, sorry ants, I got to, apologize, but I can't pick up every one of you." There's thousands upon thousands if they get in the house. But the spider dropped down to the ground and the web was gone. The web is still gone, but I just looked and the spider has spun another web here, it looks like, or some type of spider has spun a web. There's another one over there to the side of the light. So it's not using the light to attract into its web. And so I say, "That's fine, that's fine, that's fine. You have your web there." Okay, so but we don't use light to ensnare. I say, "Forget it, that's not allowed. It's not allowed." Subtle little beautiful play here, right? Amazing how many gurus have said that, the whole world was my guru. Ram Maharshi said that the whole world was my guru. Saranagata Maharaj say, to the alert mind, everything is God's grace. Everything acts helps us towards enlightenment, which is true. If you're really tuned in, you feel everything is the play of grace, because you are, your mind is alert to this play. Instead of waiting for it. So we don't wait in the wow. We're already in the wow. So we're not waiting for the wow. We're not waiting for something. We're choosing the wow right now. We're choosing the wow right now. There's no waiting around on it. We choose the wow right now. That's the first step in surfing the apocalypse, is choosing the now, the wow right now. Choose the wow right now. Choose the wow right now. Wow. Don't choose anything else. You're not making any decision. You're not saying what's right or wrong, what I need to do, or this or that. You're saying, "Wow is my decision. I'm choosing wow." It is absolutely essential that in order to surf the apocalypse, you do this practice, or the same practice can utilize something else. So if you want to use something else, then Ram Maharshi, go pay attention to Ram Maharshi and use the I. Okay, just I. That's it. Just I. Nothing else. Just I. But here, we're choosing the wow. So I don't want to mix, divide and conquer, mix things up, confuse people. We're using the wow instead of the I. It's the same practice. It's the same practice. And you could, maybe others will it suggests something other than that. Well, then go pay attention to them. Okay, so we have to have discipline here to recognize the importance of it. Where if we keep struggling, like, "Well, what should I say? Maybe I try this," or that, we're losing the battle, because we need to choose the wow right now. We need to choose the wow right now. So if you really want to surf the apocalypse and you want my help here, then you must choose the wow right now. That's all that we're going to say. In terms of our first step, the foundation of it all always gets back to choosing the wow right now. And this knocks out all other concerns. As we keep doing this, we'll find that we maintain our poise, even in the midst of horrific stuff that may be going on in the world. We're still very, very focused on that wave out there, the wave of abidance and creativity, recognition that all is in abidance in creativity, and not in any causation at all. Nothing is caught up in causation, never has been. So there's no causation we need to stop or get rid of or deal with any effects of any causation. There never have been any effects of causation at all. There's nothing to clear up. So this wave is there for us. The peace of God is there for us. We just have to get out of the one that we have been riding for so long. So I'm just, you know, letting this clarify. There needs to be more clarification before we start with this surfing the apocalypse, the second phase of it. The first phase was two months of silence on Facebook. Two months of silence on Facebook, because we needed to really let it come to us and discipline ourselves and get ready for the second phase. So silence kept too much struggle from happening. It's a very difficult time that we've been through, actually. So now we're approaching the second phase. It's a one-year intensive, really. It's a one-year intensive. From January 21st, 2017, January 21st, 2018. So from January 21st to March 21st. So if you start on the 21st, 2 months would end on the 20th, actually. And then the next phase would start on the 21st of March. It seems like that would work. So what's today? Saturday's the 18th. Sunday, 19th, Monday. So 21st would be Tuesday. So what's the next phase going to be? I don't know. Don't know yet. And the Holy Spirit's told me to wait. Hold off. I put up a new banner on the Facebook page, renamed it Surfing the Apocalypse. And now, the intensives I've done before was a struggle for everybody, because nobody's commits. They don't commit. Well, right now, in order to surf the apocalypse, you have to commit. So, you know, I have to be strict. It is the approach. We have our approach here. And if you want some other approach, then you can go somewhere else. It's that simple. I cannot be all things to everybody. We cannot have all approaches to everybody, because that's very confusing. You know, sure, the gurus can handle that, but we can't, especially those who are struggling so much. There's no way. It's overwhelming. So as a spokesperson for the Dharma means, that's a spoke for the Dharma kings. It means a spokesperson for skillful means and understanding that you don't try to say, well, you can try this or this or this or this or this or this or this. That's guaranteed failure. They will then stay on the wave that they're used to. Stay on the wave. So we just say we're just going to do one thing, one trick pony here. Okay. Full stop on the wow right now. Start it off that way. Always go back to that. And this will enable you to surf through the apocalypse, which ultimately means that you get out of the wave you're on now and start paddling towards that wave that is coming, which is really the wave of realization. But you stay in the wow as you're paddling towards the wave of realization. When you start the wow, that's getting out of the wave you're on. You're already out of it. But now you have to make sure that you don't try to get back into it. So you have to keep staying in the wow. Wow. As I'm doing this, I'm feeling better and better. I mean, I practice what I preach. I don't always do as well as I'd like to. But by giving this intensive, it helps me focus on this. Okay. And this is, I have seen how throughout history, this type of focus, of just one focus, that's the entire secret to success all throughout history. So it hasn't changed one bit. And it's been suggested to me, wow is the way to go. And I have tried it out, I've tested it, and it's been spectacular success for me. Okay, so not everybody will want to do that, okay? And fine. So find something else that you want to do to get out of that wave. But, you know, I'm not going to be dragged into all sorts of complexity and side trips, because I have to catch that wave also. It's there, and I'm in a good position to catch it, but I still have to catch that wave. So I will stick with what I know works tremendously well. And again, Ram Maharshi has endorsed this. He endorsed it quite some time ago. He said, you stick with what you're doing. I want you to stick with what you're doing. I don't want you to try to come and do the I inquiry. You do the inquiry that arises with you, which is this wow, full stop in the wow. He says, you stick with that because it's going to be very successful. So I said, okay. You know, and since then I have. Since then, since he came to me and emphatically told me to stick with it, I have stuck with it very determinedly. So I will continue to stick with it. So you can relax with that. You can say, okay, I'm going to just choose the wow. So it's choice time. If you really want to surf the apocalypse, you have to commit. So, you know, be committed in one way or the other. And here it's commitment to that wow. All equations can be summed up in simply just wow. That's the one equation we're using for the situation we're in. Okay, whatever that situation, and the one definition, what's the definition of the situation we're in? Wow is the definition. And I can feel by doing this how it takes all this pressure off me. My the deep breath, and you relax. The mind is relaxing. It says, oh my God, that's great. I don't have to try and figure something out, figure all this stuff out, and struggle with doubt and all those labels and et cetera, et cetera. No, not at all. Because the figuring out is trying to figure out, well, what's best, what's best, what's best? That's all wasted effort. What is best is one expression to cover it all. One insight settles it all. That's what's best. And for that, to have something very 360-ish and inclusive, is extremely effective. So this wow is 360 degree wow. It's wow, so it's just, it's in all directions. When you say wow, are you not kind of feeling in all directions? Yes. But is it not very abstract, like you haven't processed it yet into labels, right? You haven't processed it yet into labels. The definition, the judgment, all this doubt-based stuff, you haven't done it yet. So you refuse to do any of that. You just stay and say, no, I'm okay resting in the wow. So I've been working on this for quite some time and continue to do so, and will help you, encourage you to do so also. But you know, the relief that you feel when you stop shopping around is tremendous. As Kelly Slater said when they did an interview before a Quicksilver Gold Coast Pro surf tournament, the kickoff this year, surf championship tour. They said, how do you feel? Are you really nervous? This is our last year maybe? And he said, no, I feel very relaxed. I feel great because I committed. And he said, there's something very powerful about commitment. And by the way, he just got defeated by Gabriel Medina. I just watched it live from Australia. And I thought Slater won that heat. He was way more innovative. He threw so much great innovation and in surfing. It was beautiful surfing. Medina just kept throwing goofy foot, you know, snaps off the lip. And it's just pretty repetitive stuff. I just, you know, it didn't excite me at all. But Slater did all sorts of beautiful variety and maneuvers in sync with the wave. And I just thought, you know, that's creative surfing. I mean, that's interesting and exciting. Just doing the same goofy-footed power, you know, snap off the top of the wave. Yeah, you see a couple, and it's like, okay, but what else do you have? But for some reason, you know, they want to keep Brazil engaged with the tournament. Probably, you know, a lot of interest in surfing in Brazil. Anyway, so you know, it's pretty weird judging surf contests. I've noticed there's some interesting scoring going on. But for my money, Slater did a fabulous job. It was beautiful watching him surf. Really exciting and beautiful. And so, you know, he's Mr. Stay in the Now moment. That's his whole philosophy. They ask him, what are you going to do? I don't know. I just stay in the now. That's all I do. I don't make decisions ahead of time or anything. He's really good at that. And I said, well, that's fantastic. Anyway, commit takes this huge burden off you. A huge burden drops off of you. Because you don't have to keep slogging through the mud every single moment of the day, saying, "I don't know what to do. I don't know what to do. I don't know what to do. My gosh, the future is terrible." Ah, you know, screaming. All these people are screaming about the future. So it's terrible. I don't know. Ah, what do we do? You know, and start going. They're going into panic mode. When you commit, you're not in panic mode anymore. It's very tough to drive you into panic mode. You know what you're going to do. You're going to surf the apocalypse through use of the wow. Okay. You're going to use the wow to surf the apocalypse, which means you're going to make the right decision, which means you're going to head for that wave of realization that's coming in. Okay. And forget about that wave that you were on before. The wave of non-realization, which is really the wave of doubt. You're done with the wave of doubt. You're done with the wave of doubt. You're done with it. So now it's all about getting familiar with the wave of realization. That's it. That's what you're focused on now. And nothing can stop you. Nothing can stop you when you decide to do that. Realization is such that it's there's nothing you need to do to be realized. There's nothing, no causation to reality at all. None. It's all creation. And so you just simply get used to experiencing it. It's already as it is. It's already as it is. It's already as it is. And it's not about playing the game of, well, I'll accept the wow, but what are you going to do for me? What are you going to do for me if I accept the wow? There's none of that here. There's none of those games like that here. You accept the wow because you want to surf the apocalypse. It's your decision. I'm not going to do anything for you other than reassure you to work through that. But there's no reward I give anyone for it. You know, the reward is that there's realization as you get to surf the wave of realization. That's the reward. So people say, well, what's in it for me? Well, surfing the apocalypse is in it for me, you know, for you, for anyone. Avoiding the turmoil. If you want to look at it a negative way, well, you're avoiding all that insane turmoil that's coming. But even more to the point, you're setting yourself up. You're setting yourself in position to catch that wave of realization. Let's put it that way. You're really putting, like a surfer sees a wave coming and they're paddling. They're putting themselves in the right place in the ocean there to catch that wave. So we can paddle into position to get ready to catch the wave of realization. Now, being a Californian, I guess the Holy Spirit said, why don't you use the metaphor of surfing? And where's the... Go Hawaiian on you. You know, Hawaii's part of the United States, actually. It's not part of California, but it's our little brother to the... to the west there, from California. There's nowhere else to go from California except go to Hawaii. So the surf analogy with the ocean of samsara, you know, it fits. I like it. I like it. It works. It really does work. Especially in our more athletic age, where so many people are in great shape. It's a very useful analogy to use. So it's an action sort of thing. And you have to make an action decision. Change it, change your whole destiny by doing that. You change your entire destiny. But there's no more time to waste as far as your destiny goes, because to continue on the wave that we have been on, you know, you're not going to be able to ride that wave. You won't be. You're going to wipe out for sure. There's nowhere to go. There's nowhere to go on it. So it's not about riding the old same old wave, but, you know, talking non-dual. Okay, that's not it. That's never been it. Ramana is very clear about that. He says all heart talk is just talk. That's not it. Okay, so all the talk, this spiritual talk we do, is just talk. It's just talk. It's not it. You need to get out of the wave that you've been on. And the way to do that, again, is in order to keep your poise so you don't panic. It'll be shocking when you get out of the wave. It's shocking because you say, oh my gosh, now what? that's gone, that other wave. I'm out of that now. I'm out of it. Now what? So our expectations are shocks that we don't know quite what to expect. So again, what's pivotal is our expectations. Always, that's what's pivotal. Now, the people who are in maybe the toughest situation are the talkers, spiritual talkers, who have not committed to a practice, really committed to this singular practice, type of practice. Those are the ones who are really in a very bad situation, and you know, don't get pulled down by them. Don't get pulled down by them. I don't care who it is. You have to make your decision. When you decide to commit to, okay, I'm going to surf the apocalypse, wow. You commit to the wow to block panic. You will automatically feel that you're on the right path. And those spiritual talkers simply will not have much interest for you anymore. They will not. And this is what I've discovered for myself. I canvas a lot of spiritual talkers, and I look at them and this, and I've been losing interest in them for quite some time, because none of them really emphasize this singular practice, like Ram Maharshi emphasized, and like we're emphasizing right here. And I realized, you know, that at some point they're going to end up, you know, pulling us down, because they don't have the answer. I mean, there are lots of us who can talk the spiritual talk very glibly. Okay, that's just a personality skill that can be developed if you really want to do that. But that's not it. It's not it. So as soon as you commit to the, okay, I'm going to commit to the wow. This is a practice. I know this is going to enable me to get out of this wave and put my position to catch the wave of realization. And that's what has to be done. It's do or die time. It's decision time. Do or die decision time right now. And there's nothing I can do to force anybody to do that. If nobody does it, then nobody does it. I will continue, of course, to do it for myself. But you have to leave everything else behind. You have to leave everything. Say, no, I'm through with all the spiritual talkers, you know. Talk is cheap. Talk is cheap. It's action we need right now. And practice is really action. It's a very different thing than talk. And so many of us can talk a good game, okay. But can we really walk the walk of practicing? Actually walk the walk of practicing. And I don't mean just posing like you're being silent or something. Anyone can do that either. Now this is raw. This, you feel it. You feel the results. You're in the ocean, and you know you're into it. And you see that wave of realization. You realize that wave of realization really is there, and it's coming towards me. And I have to get in position. It's a very raw thing. It jangles your nerves. I mean, your nerves are like, wow. You know, you have to use the wow because it brings so much success. Once you kick out of that old wave, which is the wave of death, really, is the wave of death. Then you have to then get ready for the wave of eternal life, and because that's what you're going to have. And so it really pushes you to stay focused. But it's not too much. It's not too much. I've certainly been able to do it. But it engages your attention. It really does, which is great. Which is great. We want our attention engaged. I mean, what do they say? Idleness is the devil's playground or something. I mean, you don't want to be floundering, you know, shopping, still shopping for spiritual ideas and stuff. You flounder. You don't want to be floundering. You want to be engaged with your path. Your path is going, and you're paddling for that wave, and you're engaged with it, and you know it's action. You're moving towards it. And then just everything else then becomes very unimportant. Someone, a friend of mine had a child a while ago, and I said, well, you know what? They're not quite dharmic. So I said, that's good for you, because this is really going to engage your attention during this span, you know, and you're not going to be paying as much attention to the world and all this stuff, which I think that's a very positive thing for you to do, actually, because that's all they could do. So, you know, most everyone will be looking for some refuge, meaning some activity, something they can really engage in, lock into that, and try to block out all this extraneous noise. But that doesn't, you know, they're still on the same wave. And it's kind of like, well, I hope I don't wipe out too bad. It's like that. I hope I don't wipe out too bad. And so they don't panic. They try not to, you know, as they're going towards the turmoil, they try to just say, well, you know, I hope it's not too bad. And then, of course, they hope in luck. Hope they get lucky. Which, of course, lucky, the idea of luck is the idea of independent causation rather than creation, and play of doubt has to believe in luck. Okay, the play of trying to fixate hallucination, fixate the freedom of the mind, has to believe in luck and has to believe in gambling, and especially taking the long shot. Here's something that's very interesting, is that I saw a couple days ago, it might have been yesterday, very clearly, it was so wonderful to see this, that I say, why does everybody avoid the sure thing and take the long shot? Because that's the strategy of doubt. Trying to do the impossible, you have to believe there's some way, but you can't see it, and you don't think you can ever get there, so you have to believe in luck. You think, maybe I'll luck into it. Maybe I'll luck into it. Maybe there's like a one in, you know, trillion chance, but at least I have a chance, you know. You have to believe in luck to pursue the impossible. Whereas if you're not, if you get out of the wave of pursuing the impossible, you don't have to believe in luck at all. I don't believe in luck at all. I believe in the grace of God. It will most certainly save, help enable me to catch that wave of realization, that eternal wave of realization. So it's a sure thing. So what I'm doing is taking the sure thing. It's certain to work. Whereas I see most of the rest of the world, they're taking the longest of long shots. They say, well, you know, this might work. I don't know. Maybe I'll get lucky and it'll work. And they keep doing that. So this is the undoing of everyone in this world, is continuing to take a long shot so you can believe in luck. Because if you take the sure thing, there's no luck involved. It takes luck out of the equation. So in order to believe that we can do the impossible and fixate freedom, we have to believe in luck. And so we can't take the sure thing, because then there's no luck involved. So that's why people keep refusing to take the sure thing. That's why. It's not because the sure thing is too difficult or doesn't work or anything. It's because it does. There's no room in it for luck. No room in it for luck. Let me check the sound on this. I know the audio's been having some problems. That sounds okay. Sounds great. You know, just sometimes it's the computer that's the problem, not the microphone. The microphone's fine. It's something internal in the computer. Occasionally electricity will start fizzing, you know, just fizzy. But, you know, but the gist of this, I keep repeating myself so you get the gist of it over and over and over and get familiar with it. Because familiarity is what wins, is what catches us, catches the wave. Whereas analysis, intellectual and conceptual analysis, is what loses. That's the wave we want to get off of, that wave, and trust in familiarity. Have faith in familiarity. Okay, that's not luck. Familiarity is not luck. It's repetitive, 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 repetitive. Get used to it. Now, absolutely, vitally important to keep repeating this and keep hearing it, because familiarity will set in, just like watching the surf contest. The first surf contest I've ever watched. And so I started out, I was a complete novice. I didn't know what to expect. I had no idea what to expect. I said, but I'm going to do this. And I was really nervous at first, really shaking. I was so nervous. I said, wow, I don't know what this is going to be like. And now I've watched most of the contest. I'm up to the semifinals now, which is, who is it? It's Owen Wright's in there, and Gabriel Medina, and John Florence, and, or was it Owen, who, and, was it Wilkinson, something like that, something like that. Anyway, they got some heavyweights in the semifinals. So I'm up to the semifinals. So I'm learning a lot. I've learned a lot. I've gotten familiar with it by just putting a lot of time in. I mean, the heats are like 27 minutes, something like that, 25 minutes. They're pretty long, and I've watched a lot of heats. I've watched most of the heats, you know. So I'm putting in hours and hours and hours and hours and hours watching this surf contest. I really am. I stay up till late at night watching it, because in Australia it's daytime, so I can watch it. It's on live late at night here in California. It's on right now, as a matter of fact. It has to be, I guess, early in the morning time there. And so I'm getting used to it. I'm really starting to get used to it. But to start off, I was really, really nervous. I said, can I even handle this? Am I going to be an idiot? I mean, am I going to be completely confused? I mean, what's going to happen here? And then gradually, I didn't understand how all the brackets work, and I'm understanding that the fourth round's not a knockout round, that the winners go into the quarterfinals automatically, and then the two losers, they pair off for another round of surfing, and the winners of those then go into the quarterfinal bracket also. So I understand that. I've seen the politics of judging, local favorites, and just getting the flavor, how the audience there participates, priority, understanding how priority works and how blocking works, and what criteria the judges are using for the waves. And so I'm just getting tuned into the entire surfing scene. Really am. It's been a crash course in learning all this. But I spent hours and hours and hours and hours, just every day I'm going to it a lot to get familiar with it. There's a familiarity there. And that's something that's just it sets in quietly and gently, familiarity. It's not like analysis where you say, I got it. It's not like that. You don't get it. You don't get familiarity. It's not something you get. It's something that comes in imperceptibly, with imperceptible gentleness. And you get the language. I still have quite a ways to go with the various stuff that they call, but I'm getting familiar with it. I can't really tell you what it is right now, but I'm getting familiar with it. Should I flip this light on? It's starting to, the contrast is what's, because the sun is blasting me right now. We're getting familiar, and so this is how it has to work. It's blasting everything, the sun. Wow, that's cool. That means it's that time of the year where the sun has moved north enough to be hitting me like this. That's great. I mean, sunny days ahead. We get an extra hour in the afternoon. I'm going to have to start using that some way. So far, so good with the taping. Great. Familiarity, 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 familiarity. And I'm just listening to the announcers. They're announcing the surf contest. And I'm watching it. And I'm just getting familiar with it. And down the road, add to it if I want to. And so it just feels like, yeah, I've been there. I've done that. I'm getting familiar with this. I understand what they're talking about. I understand some of the strategy, the blocking strategy, the various stuff like that. And I'm starting to be able to judge the waves now pretty well, as far as what I think. I'm trying to say, what are the judges going to give this ride? And I'm pretty much on it pretty well. I'm getting better and better at it already. What are they looking for? What are the surfers trying to do? Et cetera, et cetera. So it's a really quite amazing experience. But don't be surprised if you feel really jittery at first. Just have faith and say, okay, this is part that I'm starting something that I'm not familiar with. So that's where the jitters come from. It's not that it's wrong. It's just that I'm not familiar with it yet. And there isn't any way to really do it except put in the time and effort and go through the jitters. Just keep wowing it. Wow, 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 wow. So I don't know exactly what my role will be, but I'm not going to teach anything else, really, in terms of, it's practice time. It's action time means practice time. Now, if something, if the Holy Spirit clarifies it for me in some way more, that's great. Let me see if I can switch this on. If I can play a larger role at some point, great. So this is really an ecumenical approach. It doesn't require one to be any particular religion at all, or non-religion. It's just, wow, it's a mental technique. It's the ultimate mental technique. So if someone asks a question, I would just say, wow. The answer is wow to that. So for those who are committed, they say, oh yeah, thanks. Okay, I got it. The answer is wow. That's right. All answers are just wow. And you know, it's not like if you, well, I say I did it for a year, where's my prize? No, there's no prize. I'm not giving out any prizes. It's just what you put into it is what you get out of it. There's no teacher here giving a grade. There's no grade. You grade yourself. It's self-graded. And I don't tell you what your grade is. You know, you have to grade yourself on it. Every day, you grade yourself. I don't give out any grades. I'm not grading anything. So when you commit to it, there'll be this process of getting familiar with it. You just have to pay attention, and then you'll feel like, oh, you know, you start doing it, and you say, "Wow, I got it. I can do it. I can do this," and then you're off and running. Find a comfortable seat or bench, sit down, and be quiet and. Allow yourself to luxuriate in just the wow. Luxuriate in not having to search anywhere else. There's no need for any search. You found it. The wow is what you needed to find, and you found it. So just relax in that and luxuriate in this no more seeking mode. We're not trying to go beyond seeking. That will happen when we're familiar enough with the wave of realization that's coming in. Of its own accord, when we're ready for it. But right now, we found the last, we found what we've been seeking for, which is wow. And it's really paying honor to our creativity. It's helping us pay honor to our creativity also. We don't want to let this dream go without at least a last goodbye sort of thing, you know. So wow is like the final goodbye. You know, we're saying our final fond farewells, or maybe not so fond farewells. That may be the case. Or maybe both, a mixture, right? Our dream has been a nightmare, hasn't it? For me, it's been a nightmare, but of course our creativity has always shines through, echoes through. In some way, feebly, feebly, but still, it's there, and we realize it's really all just our creativity, and so there's a little bit of fondness here and there, but mostly, it's been a nightmare of insecurity and frantic efforts to heal this, fix this insecurity, and none of them work, and they only get us in even worse insecurity. You know, it's like, it's a nightmare. This dream is a nightmare. The more you try to flee from the monster, the bigger the monster gets. That's a nightmare, isn't it? Instead of getting smaller, it gets bigger and more vicious. And you think, oh my God, I gotta run faster. And you run faster, and that just makes it even bigger and more vicious. That's the very definition of nightmare, isn't it? Oh my gosh, you say, this is horrible. the more we try to fixate reality, the more insecure we feel. Or hallucination, rather. The more we try to fixate hallucination, the more insecure we feel. Which drives us to then try even harder to fixate it, which just makes us feel even more insecure. So it's a vicious downward spiral, this dream. Vicious downward spiral. And as you're spiraling down, you know, you might say, oh, there's some pretty clouds, that's a nice tree, it's a nice day, there's a good bottle of wine, you know, it's nice food, but inside you're panicking. It's like, my gosh, the monster's worse than ever. I can't seem to run fast enough. And then you get into ways to try to make you flee from it faster, and that just, again, makes it even worse, even worse. So at some point you stop, you say, wait a minute. I wonder if, like, stopping will help. And when you stop, the monster stops. And when you start walking toward the monster, it starts backing off and getting smaller. And you say, hey, I wonder if this works. But then you turn around and flee again, and then suddenly the monster gets stronger and chasing after you and bigger, and you say, oh my gosh, it's back, oh my gosh. Just like that. But again, you get out of this what you put into it. It's not like you can say, well, I've committed, so how are you going to help me now? Say, no, it's not like that. It's not like that. When you commit, you will feel it. And you will feel this burden drop away from you. Now, you'll feel nervous too, but you'll feel the burden drop away. And say, oh my gosh, this is the best thing that's ever happened. I've actually have found the answer to what I'm seeking. And you will know it. You will know it. There's an inner knowing. I know I finally got it. And so then at that point, you just practice. Keep practicing as much as possible. It's like, you know, nobody can work out for you. It's not like you say, okay, I committed to working out. So, and then you just sit there and don't work out. What is that? It's absurdity. If you commit to working out, you actually start working out. And you say, oh, I can do this. I was swinging the golf club today, and it's like, my new grip, I said, oh, I can do this. I have this new grip that works. And yeah, I was putting strong swings on it. Strong swings, without trying to really hurt myself, that's what I'm trying to do. I can swing really hard, but that puts too much strain on the body. So you want to be in such great shape that even your three-quarter swings are really powerful. And if you really need to, you can just go all out, add a little extra. But that's when you hurt yourself. So my back was kind of strained for a while because I swang too hard. And I realized, no, next time, just put a really strong three-quarter swing on. You know, make the three-quarter swing as strong as possible. But don't wind up all the way and try to put 100% all in massive swing, because that's going to put too much strain on the body. Same thing with your spiritual practice is make a real strong three-quarter practice. And that'll be plenty. Keep working at it. Keep getting strong, strong, strong. But you don't have to do some, you know, five-hour practice of wow, or, you know, just something that just burns you out. You don't have to do that. Just make sure your practicing is really strong, but not as strong as it could possibly be. Because then you find burnout. Now, occasionally you want to do that. I did that a couple of weeks ago with starting this meditation. I'm an apex yogin. Wow. I used that as a meditation, intense meditation, and was able to recognize really the whole landscape. And wow. So I really pushed in a tremendous way, but then I was exhausted and I couldn't keep going after three days of that. So I have to realize now, okay, did that. Let's keep surfing the momentum of that. Let's keep taking the momentum of this. Wow, it's going to be terrible to say goodbye to the sun. We're just getting used to it again here. And here comes the cloudy, rainy weather. Kind of a drag. But, which means we'll get a chance to say hello to the sun again after this 10 days or so, you know, hopefully are over. We'll get to say hello to the sun again. So it's all good in that way. But in the meantime, we're getting ready for this phase, like a phase in the world is a turmoil, by really committing. And so when the rain starts, which would be the 21st, pretty much, the day the new phase of the intensive will be this new phase, and I'll be really into this new phase, whatever this may be. I'm not sure exactly what it will be, but it will be something. And we'll just give me an opportunity to really get into it really strongly. And who knows? Who knows what'll happen? I mean, you got the Dharma Kings here taking care of their spokesperson. So committing to being their spokesperson, or, you know, one of their spokespersons. I don't just a spokesperson for the, I am a spokesperson for the Dharma Kings. We'll see what they do. They might say, hey, great, you know, we need to shift your circumstances a little bit here to make this work. I don't know. I tried it like Kelly Slater. I stay in the now. I stay in the moment. I try not to anticipate what's going to happen down the road. Just be in the now, the wow of the now. Be in the wow of the now right now. Be in the wow right now. Be in the wow right now. So I've got it all figured out. Wow is how I got it all figured out. So when all the number crunching that's ever going to be done in the future by all the computers that will ever be assembled, we already know what the answer is from all that computation. It's wow. Okay? And all the experience that we put in the past, all the dying, everything we've done, the struggle, the strain, the experience, all of that equates to just what? Wow. So I know the lessons of the past. What are the lessons of the past? The lessons of the past are wow. So I've learned the lessons of the past, which is wow. And I already know all the lessons of the future. All the wisdom of the future will boil down and it will be wow. So what a relief to be free of the past and the future, right? What a relief. And yet we have something that at least honors them, right? All the wisdom of the past and all the wisdom to come in the future, I know, already know what it is. It's wow, I've got it. And then ultimately, we go even beyond wisdom itself. Ultimately, but not right now. We'll keep practicing the wow. Ultimately, we realize that reality doesn't need any wisdom. It's creativity's doing just fine, thank you. There's no causation to have wisdom about, actually. But that's, you know, down the road. That'll just organically dawn upon us when we keep practicing properly. And there's really nothing we can say about it. There's nothing we can say about creativity that translates well at all to what we're practicing. So it's just the wave is there. It's coming in. We're just getting ourselves in position. Let's not get ahead of ourselves. It'll take a lot of work to get in the right position for it. So we make sure that we do this work. But it's nice to tape outside and it's warm enough and it's pleasant. I said, this is very good. We're getting to that time. So I was told be ready by the 18th, and you know, meaning reached a certain base level, which I have done. So then we can now shift gears for the 21st. And counting from the 21st, did I count from the 21st? I think if we count from the 21st, or even the 22nd, yeah, we get right there to the 23rd of September. We're right there, 144 days. Isn't that extraordinary? Isn't that extraordinary? Or is it from April? The end of April. I can't remember. Maybe it's from the end of April, right? It's the end of April. But there's something else from... Well, certainly you go from the first day of spring to the first day of autumn, kind of thing. That sort of spans this time span of spring and summer. So we have like spring and summer to get ready for the 23rd of September. So that's our next big date, is the 23rd of September. Okay, that's a really, really big date. It's a wonderful one. It's very heavy date. So we have this date with the 23rd of September. And we get to see what, you know, kind of the next 6 months. I mean, I don't know, what is it? From the 20th, let's say the 20th of March. So we go, let's count April. April, May, June, July, August, and September. 6 months. We'll have 6 months to really work on this as best we can. So we want to hit September 23rd. We want to be sure we get there. We want to be sure we get to September 23rd. So make that date in your mind. Say, you know what? I have a date. I have the wow and I have a date. That's pretty good, right? So you have this intensive date. So you want to keep it through your, at least to the 23rd of September. So you could say, I'm doing this, you know, 6 month intensive. And then we'll see about extending it to October, November, December. And then finishing it off into January 21st with a final finish off month. So commit to the 23rd of September. This is so important. This is what we need to do. That date is so important now. It's very, very heavy with significance. So it's not a full year commitment, but it's half a year commitment. So at this point, since it's such a do or die situation, a half a year commitment is very doable for everyone, actually. You're just going to commit to the well. And so this takes everything else off the table for spring and summer, which is super important because there could be a lot of turmoil coming. A lot of turmoil coming in these next 6 months. But you, by committing, you've already taken that off the table. It's off the table. You have a six-month intensive going on here. And I don't need to write that into the title of Facebook, whatever. It's serving the apocalypse is good enough. If you commit, you know what it's about. So we have the six-month commitment. And we'll see how we are when we get to September 23rd. Meanwhile, we'll just grind along with all the creativity and inspiration that we can get. And so far, this is recording really beautifully, which is great. I tried something different. I'm recording to an external hard drive now instead of a memory chip. And so far, it's worked beautifully. So this is good news. I just decided to try it. I've been thinking about doing this, and I keep saying, no, keep procrastinating. Finally, I just said, you know, I just got to plug this in and try it. And it wasn't difficult just plug it in, but procrastination is really a monster, isn't it? And we all have that monster on our back. But we cannot afford to continue to procrastinate at this time, at this moment. We cannot. And, you know, what can I do? If there are those that do so, there's nothing I can say about it. Nothing I can say about it. It's deadly. Procrastination at this point in time is very deadly. And that means that they still caught up in the habits that of hope and fear, taking the long shot. Maybe death will work, they're saying. Maybe death will work is what they hope, that maybe they'll have someone will have a lucky death. And that lucky death will fixate the mind. And then they think then the insecurity will vanish. No, insecurity doesn't vanish until we drop the whole attempt to hallucinate. It's the only way insecurity vanishes for us. The only way. It will never vanish for us as long as we continue to hallucinate the absence of God. It will never vanish for us. Only when we give up hallucinating the absence of God will insecurity vanish for us. It's the only way. Not sacrifice. Sacrifice never works. That's trying to keep the hallucinating the absence of God and find a way to fixate it. That will never, ever work. Now, I wish my knee were better. It's still problematical. I say, wow, it's keeping me from doing much of anything except taping, and which is good. If it gets better, I'll probably start doing more stuff. If it decides to get better, if my mind decides that my knee is going to be well, then it will be well, or if, you know, the grace of God. But it keeps me not, you know, gallivanting around or doing anything at this point. Maybe it'll suddenly start feeling strong again. No reason why it can't. It comes and it goes, which is fine. I just have to let it be what it is. I'm trying to get my weight down even further. 167. I want to get to see, hit 167. Trying to see if that's possible. How cool would that be to go into the summer of 217 at 167, retrospectively going back to the summer of love in 1967, which came from the Bay Area, summer of love in 67. Which was a pivotal time where spirit had been trying to do the right thing. And it was ambivalent. It was an ambivalent time enough so we were able to shift out of some old bad habits. So ambivalent times are helpful. They really are. They enable us to shift out of bad habits. But you don't want to shift into worse habits, which is what happened for many. They shifted into even worse habits because spirit panicked. It didn't know how to handle the ambivalence because it doesn't know about the wow practice, about that taking just one conclusion, you know, from everything in the future and everything in the past. You already have the conclusion, and you're not searching for any other conclusion whatsoever. Okay, the genius of this, wow, not seeking or surfing for any other conclusion. You already have all conclusions from all history and from all whatever the future is going to bring as it turns into history, that you've already got the conclusion. It's wow. That's it. Because at some point it'll be wow, nothing ever happened. There's never been any history at all. There's never been any time at all. Ultimately, you have to realize that. And so that's wow, isn't it? Wow. So this is it's like a, you know, it's a USB 2 port in a 1.8 terabyte hard drive. And so maybe, you know, it will upload faster too. Maybe everything will be smoothed out by this. I hope so. I could use it. It's been a rocky time here, very, very unsmooth with the taping. But that's a transition. We've been in a transition. So we're in transitional time right now. You know, so surf up. You know, surf up. So surf up, like cowboy up. You know, surf up, meaning. Make your decision. You're going to have to surf one wave or the other. You're going to be surfing no matter what. Decide to say, you know what? I have a way now to get to that wave of realization. I really have the way to do it. And I understand what's being said. It's being explained very clearly here. And the problem I have with it is not one of clarity. It's one of familiarity. So asking questions doesn't work. You just have to keep hearing, because I'm saying everything that needs to be said already. So there's no call for any questions, actually. It's simply you have to do it and get familiar with doing it. And then you will see for yourself. You start getting the hang of it, and you say, wow, I can do this. I can do this. And I'll do it as my protection from the next 6 months. And so even, you know, it's, it's the safety net. It's the safety net I have, the safety net. And since I already know what all conclusions will be, and the final, when the final trumpet is sounded on all of existence, conditioned existence, I already know what the conclusion will be, and it's wow. So I already have it. So I don't need to go through all the turmoil at all. Because it will all come out in the end as wow. And I already have the answer for it all. No need to go through any of the turmoil. What a powerful leverage you see over what's to come in this world. You have this ultimate leverage now. Ultimate leverage. You just have to use it. I'm just giving you the leverage, telling you, here's the leverage. And just use it. It's free. It's free. You don't need to do anything for me. It's free. But the leverage has to be used. You have the leverage, a mental leverage, where you do not need to engage with the world anymore in terms of seeking for anything. You can engage with the world, not as engagement, but simply it will appear ultimately as just this creative display. That's all. This beautiful creative display. That's it. Ultimately. And we'll get there. I know I'll get there. I'm already starting to tune into that and say, oh yeah, understanding what's the Dharma King say about that. So that's coming for me. It's I'm starting to recognize, okay, yeah, and I getting familiar with this. Creative display, yeah. There's no causation happening at all. So it's just all creative display. That's all that is present right now. And at some point that will, you know, dawn upon my perception, I'll be able to see it that way. And then it's just, everything's just beautiful. It's all so beautiful. As they sang back in the 60s, it's all so beautiful. Ichiku Park, I think, it's all so beautiful. Of course, they were on drugs. And that turned out to not be it. Right? Not be it at all. It turned out to be a bummer. I mean, we've been on a bummer for 44 years. Been on a bad trip, you know, the price we pay was a bad trip for the last 44 years. Drugs really put you on a long-term bummer. You may not see it right away, but take it from me, with hindsight on the whole thing. I mean, nobody did more drugs than the 60s, the people in the 60s. I mean, they really went all in on it. And now we have the hindsight, 44 years of a bummer, really bad trip. And we already have the conclusion about all drugs. It's wow. Okay, we don't need to do drugs. We already know the conclusion of everything. It's wow is the conclusion. No need for any drugs at all. Here, no need at all. No need for any to put yourself through any situation at all. In particular here, we already have the conclusion. So the door is wide open to just experiencing everything as creative display in the now. Experiencing the peace of God upon everything. The door is wide open now. Don't need sex, don't need drugs, don't need rock and roll. Because the conclusion for all of that and for everything that will ever seem to happen in conditioned existence is wow, we already have the final conclusion. Final answer, you know, we've got it. So we just use that leverage now. To get familiar with the peace of God being upon us, the peace of God being upon us. Creative experience, everything is simply creative display. It's all beautiful, equally beautiful, smooth, creative display, ornamentation of spaciousness. Intrinsic spaciousness ornamenting itself is all that's taking place, actually. In perfect freedom of the now, with no causation at all just the play of creativity. Yeah, it's gone over an hour and it's still smooth. And the screen hasn't cut out and all this crazy stuff. So it's a smooth recording. How about that? We're getting smoothness here now. I love this. It's good. On Facebook, I'm getting all these requests from mostly women, or gangster type of guys. And like, what? I put up all these pictures, you know, Sri Sri Narayana, and these are the requests I get. I said, what in the world? But it's interesting. The women are like traditional women. They're saying, come on back to, you know, the sexiness, you know, of traditional women. And I say, no, I'm not, you know, that's gone. But I know that's bad. Okay, I know that doesn't work. But what has been problematical is the feminists, right? They say, well, we're non-traditional. We're like men now. You know, it's like, huh? We've had 44 years to figure out that doesn't work. Because I already know the answer is wow to everything. We have the answer, so don't need that either. But it's easier to reject the traditional feminine for a man than it is the non-traditional feminine, which is strutting around the world, roaring the Amazons, you know. It's like, huh, you know, I wonder if that might give me some sort of answer or something. It's easier. So that's good. So we're taking a step back in order to take a leap forward, kind of thing. But I say, yeah, okay. Yeah, look at my picture. Aren't you pretty? Aren't, you know, oh, so you're so pretty. Oh, you look great. You know, it's like, you know. It's like, oh, yeah, that again. No. No, that doesn't work. So, but we don't need to go through any of that. But so it's like the old thing you already know isn't it. It's helpful right now. So I realized that. This is very helpful. Thank you. It's very helpful. It's like Trump is very helpful. Yes, okay, we know that doesn't work. Okay? But that's helpful because we know it doesn't work, so now we can turn to the wow. I mean, say, but I know the answer for everything already, so that's great. So it's good to go back to what we know doesn't work when we're ready to take a leap forward. So we don't get intrigued with maybes. Okay, we don't want to get intrigued by maybes. So if we had Hillary, people would be saying, you know, maybe we don't know what's going to happen. Maybe, you know, and then we stay on the wave. That was really bad. But now we say, okay, well, Trump, okay, you know, we know how that goes. We know it doesn't work. We know the traditional feminine doesn't work. The traditional masculine doesn't work. Great. So let's focus on what the answer is, and it's wow is the answer. So it's a beautiful help. It's a beautiful help. That's why I couldn't figure out why is Sri Sri Narayana Ma sending me these people. It's because she wanted to say, she's saying, go back to what you know doesn't work. How about that for brilliance? And just stay away from all the nouveau stuff, you know. Just stay with what you know doesn't work. It's a lot safer. And you say, okay, I know it doesn't work. Okay, now back to the wow, right? And this strengthens the wow. And so I've been able to strengthen the wow, get this leverage, realizing this is the sum total of all dreaming, the ultimate conclusion from everything. So we don't need to put ourselves through anything at all. And that needs to be reinforced. But the temptation comes from the innovation of gender innovation That's where the temptation can come in, and innovation and gender leadership and gender this, that's why the ego has been, well, it's the spirit really. There's no ego really. A spirit is ambivalence, and when it panics, it says, let me innovate on trying to fixate hallucination. I got to keep myself interested in it, so it has to innovate. So we're going away from that innovation back to the traditional. What we already know doesn't work. Oh, we've been there, done that, not interested. And but stay away from all innovation, gender innovation. That's what will trick us into, staying on the wave of wipe of death, actually. Because all innovation there could possibly be, it all will end up with simply being wow. That's it. All innovation that's taken place in the past as well, all innovation that could take place in the future as well. Whatever gender bending is done throughout the next trillion years, if you want it to be, it will all end up simply as wow. So we already have the answer, you see. So we don't need to do any of that stuff. Don't get dragged along the wave of innovation at all. Same thing with all technological innovation. We already know where that all, it all ultimately ends on the peak of where, wow. That's what it ends up as. That's the sum total of it all. So the sum total of all conditioned existence, no matter how it plays out, is simply wow. That's it. Not a shred more or less. Just that. Just that. And how is it that I'm able to do this at School of Hard Knocks? I got beat up too much. Really, that's why. I got tired of getting beat up, And that's how I did it. You just say, that's it. I'm committed to finding the answer to all this. I'm committed. Enough of this dream, getting enough of the nightmare. I had too many nightmares, plain and simple. Suffered. Got desperate. I can't handle this suffering anymore. I got desperate, and ultimately saw that we're trying to innovate our way into total chaos, and we're still insecure. Even with total chaos, we still are insecure with the total insecurity. We think we can fixate insecurity by being totally insecure, and that doesn't even work. And that's what I experienced. So directly experiencing that, I realize I don't have any choice at all. I have no choice at all. So that's how I got to be where I am now as a spokesperson for the Dharma Kings. I realize I don't have any choice. And that's the most powerful motivation of all. When you really know you don't have any choice, then, hey, there's nowhere to go except do the work, right? Stay super motivated and do the work. So that's it. That's the sum total of all the secrets. It's just I realized I had absolutely no choice at all. Tried the ultimate trick, of spirit, tried the ultimate trick of being, totally insecure with insecurity. Didn't work. Doesn't work. I saw this doesn't work. I still feel insecure. It's the same insecurity. Nothing happened. Nothing happened. That didn't fixate. It's like spirit tries to make a new insecurity that's greater than the insecurity that we're feeling already, so we can get rid of the insecurity we're feeling already. That's kind of what it does. So it tries to give you total mental chaos. But the insecurity that we're feeling about trying to fixate mind is still there. It doesn't go anywhere. Because mind can't be fixated. As I said, oh my gosh, even this doesn't work. So nothing is going to work. There's no doubt about it. Because trying to replace the insecurity we feel by an imaginary mental chaos, that is still, the mind is still doing that, and the mind can stop doing that instantly. And that's what I discovered. I just stopped total mental chaos. And I said, oh my gosh, the mind even has power over total mental chaos. That's just being imagined too. It's being imagined too. That won't work. And then instantly, I realized, game's up. Game's up. I got no choice. And then right away, I asked for help. The Holy Spirit showed up right away. The grace of God, it was there right away. Said, don't worry. You've got it. You've got this. I said, oh, the Holy Spirit said, I've got this for you. And I guarantee it for you. The first thing the Holy Spirit guaranteed it for me. It's guaranteed. You're going to succeed now. Guaranteed. And so then with that faith there, and the results, I just kept working with the faith results, faith results, faith results. Now I'm a spokesperson for the Dharma Kings. So it's like that. Simple. Now, externalizing chaos doesn't work. That's anarchy. That's not as strong as experiencing it, literally experiencing it in your own mind within you, with nothing causing it. It's just you try to imagine total chaos, what will happen with me. That's way more powerful than trying to cause external total chaos, externally anarchy, which Spirit is considering doing that. And I say to Spirit, it's just more delay. Because you'll always feel, well, it's not total mental chaos. I could do this, I could do this, you know. But when you experience your own mind, the mind, imaginary mental chaos in your mind, that's total, totally total imaginary mental chaos, that's totally direct. And then you instantly can see how that has no effect on your insecurity and didn't fixate the mind at all. And at that point, you immediately know you have no choice anymore. That you have no choice now but to drop hallucination. So that's way more powerful. And we don't need external chaos for that to happen. We don't need it. I did it in 1978. That happened. That's what it took place. And you know, the world was just going along at that time, and it wasn't anarchy in the world. So we don't need the anarchy in the world. That makes it, that gives a false, what we're trying to do is say, well, we tried it and it might work. You know, that kind of thing. I didn't, you know, it said, well, maybe it works and maybe it doesn't work. That's how Spirit wants to maintain this ambivalence. So it can say, yeah, well, I tried anarchy and, well, I'm not sure if it worked or if it didn't work. It might work if I try it again, you know, that kind of thing. Then we're just spinning our wheels. We're just spinning our wheels. There's no point to try and anarchy. So I'm trying to help Spirit see this. Spirit's trying to help itself see this. And then it can back off anarchy and say, okay, wow. So we're trying to make an artificial insecurity, total insecurity, artificial, imagine it, to try and replace the real insecurity we're feeling as we're trying to hold on to a hallucination, because to hold on to a hallucination has to be totally insecure, really, right? Because mind is free, so any instant at all, that hallucination could vanish, totally vanish, like it never was, like it never was. Because creativity is such, it's always free. So the past is like it never was in terms of creativity, because it's not having any effect on the present at all. And yet, it's in creativity, it's still there as creative display, so to speak. It's just, it's hard, we can't really explain it in terms of time and imagination, all what we're used to. We cannot explain it. Whatever we create is eternal, and yet it has no impingement on the now. So it's not like when we choose a different experience that the previous one then dies. No, it's eternal. It's eternal. It's been added to creation. But in no way is our continuing freedom compromise in the slightest bit. And that is something that's beyond our capacity to imagine, actually. It really is. And we shouldn't try to. But it's just a heads up. That is not like what we choose to experience when we choose something different, that previously is somehow experienced as a death that's no longer available, no longer present. It's added to the overall presence of creativity. It's extending the overall presence of creativity. So we never lose anything. We never lose anything. But of course, trying to develop the capacity to lose, is that we're just aimlessly, we're not really being creative. We're not adding to the creativity of creation. We're not adding anything. We're not extending it. We're just like stalled out kind of thing. We're not extending it. Because we're just trying to develop a new power to, you know, fixate our freedom. And we can't do that. So we're not really extending creation the way creation is meant to be extended. But that's okay. Everything that we have created up till now is still present. It's entirely present. And everything we will create going forward will always be present. So I mean, it's not like we've lost anything at all. We've just kind of, you know, we've just been aimless for a little while. Hallelujah. Imaho. Wow. Smooth recording so far. A lot of disk space free. 1,850.9 gigabytes are free. So I can do a lot of taping here. I can like tape around the clock for the next 6 months. And it will still be plenty of space. And of course I can buy a new external hard drive. I never thought about that before. It's amazing. My old one is having problems, and I said, what do I do? I couldn't understand what to do. Then I have to commit to a new one. I said, what if that fills up? Wait a minute. I mean, they're just like floppy disks. I mean, you could buy as many external hard drives as you want and just unplug them. This is USB powered. We don't want to use it, just unplug it. When you want to use it, just plug it back in. If you fill it up, just buy another one and just keep them in storage, just like CDs. You know, I never thought about that. Never occurred to me I could do that. Isn't that weird? Yeah. It's just so much storage. You think, well, if that you fill it up, that's it. But no, you could buy 1,000 of them. Just fill them all up if you want. It's like a library of external hard drives. And just grab any one you want to. And there's the video. You can you know, have the video right there. Just amazing. Unless we lose our atmosphere. And then the solar flares come in and wipe out all data. Which, you know, could happen. If we want anarchy, there you got anarchy. You know, Spirit has this whole plan of potential anarchy for this world and ultimately destruction of this world. It has this whole mental intention scenario that it's considering. And we want to say, Spirit, consider once again. Consider once again based on what we're telling you here. Not so fast, okay? Not so fast. So Spirit's listening to this. It's listening to itself is what it's doing. And likely making some adjustments. That's the benefit of anyone who is able to speak like this to Spirit. Is it Spirit actually does make adjustments. It says, huh, maybe it's not quite as bad as I thought. Oh, okay, so imagining total chaos to replace the total insecurity, replace the insecurity you have. Okay, that also is insecure to the mind. Oh my gosh, it doesn't work. It can't work, right? Oh, wow. Like that. And you only experience it for an instant, and right away, it's so horrible. Total insecurity is so horrible. You only experience it for an instant, but you're aware also that it doesn't work. So that's a lot easier path than trying to create external anarchy. It's infinitely easier. Infinitely easier. Infinitely less delay, so much less delay, right? So spirit, I say, you know, you can do this. We can do this. We can do it. No problem. No problem at all. Realize you have no choice, and then spiritual path is difficult. It's tough work, but give it 40 years of tough work, and you got it. And that's it. Then no more troubles, no more insecurities. Wow, right? Wow, very wowish. So when Ramana says, well, this is very helpful, you know, what is he talking about? I don't know exactly, because I'm certainly not communicating with hardly anyone, and you know, it doesn't seem to be resonating with anyone in the world, but maybe it's resonating with spirit at a deep level. Maybe that's what he's saying. And then later on, he says, down the road, many will be helped by this. But first, it needs to resonate with spirit. Spirit needs to say, wow, got something here. I didn't realize this. Just like I didn't realize I could buy as many external hard drives as I want. You know, I can just store as much data as I want. I was all freaked out about, I can't store, I'm running out of space. I can't defragment the disk. I'm doomed. Suddenly I say, my gosh, I could be adding data forever if I want to. So I'm not doomed at all in that way. Just like that, spirit can realize, hey, I'm not doomed to eternal insecurity. Not at all. I can actually be free right now by just accepting the conclusion, the one conclusion from everything I could possibly do to try and fixate the mind is just wow. All wisdom is wow. I already have all wisdom right here, right now. Already have all wisdom right here, right now, and it's wow. So I have to have faith in spirit, that spirit is hearing this, can hear this, and it will help. So I have faith in that. I have faith. I feel somehow spirit is, you know, is aware of this, taking it in. The only friend request I blocked was from a feminist. I should have maybe blocked more of them. I finally drew the line. I said, no, 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 no. But maybe I shouldn't have blocked that one either. Because actually she was, well, it was more like, she's actually a traditional control freak. Maybe that's not a feminist. But I felt like, she was totally into activism and feminism and all this kind of stuff, which is, you know, the path of trying to be intrigued, and that's, you have to block that. So I will block feminists. I will block feminists. If I feel someone's a feminist activist, I'll block that. Because that is the trap that will cause us to fail. Is anything that's in innovation. If somebody's trying to present innovation, I'll block them. I will. We're not, the one innovation is wow, and that's all we need. That's the sum total of all innovation that can ever take place. And the safe path is to go back to the traditional that we already, not really interested in, you know, all these beauty queens like, you know, no thanks. It's easy to say that, no thanks, no. So this is good, you stay with the traditional. Which is why I'm a conservative, social conservative, because it's the wisdom path. It's stay with what you know doesn't work and avoid the innovation when you have the answer for everything. That's a no-brainer. Thank you, Sri Sri Anandamayama and the Dharma Kings, for your, you know, just perfect help. So if I feel there's intrigue, I'll have to, block the person. If it's, a mysterious intrigue, if I get this feeling, then that's danger. That's danger for us. We need to be very traditional right now, very conservative, very traditional. You call it traditional, very traditional, very traditional. I dress conservatively. I dress, pretty traditionally, just fit in. I mean, also, modern, but just I try to just be very traditional. Play golf. I play golf. Very traditional, conservative sport, right? I hope I can play. My swings were great. I mean, my swings are powerful, and I have not hit any golf balls, but if my knee holds up, I can play golf. Play golf again. I feel like I can move the ball out there, move it around. The strength is there. I discovered something else really important. I mean, super important today about this has a spiritual kind of, carryover too, but golf, engage the core. I had never done that before. And so before I swing, I kind of move the club back and forth and tense up my whole core and my legs so I feel really, it's all engaged, and then swing. And I keep my balance and the strength is there really good. You know what? Before, I never did that before. I tried to relax my whole core and be relaxed. And that this causes you to be off balance too much. If you engage your core, you feel very solid and stable. And I got this term, engage your core, from this online surf coach. And it just clicked as it said that. I said, oh my gosh, I've never done that. And I suddenly realized today, I've never done that with my golf swing. I've never done that. Just the opposite. I tried to leave the core unengaged. I said, whoa. So I got a whole new swing. Engage the core and don't grip the right hand too tightly. Leave the first index and thumb and index finger off of the grip entirely. Leave it off of the grip. It doesn't play any role. So you don't grip too tightly. Don't try to overpower with the strength in your right side. It keeps you from over the right side from overpowering the swing, which is the mistake, the fault that we all make, is we use our dominant side, this to try to get the strength from there. And when doing that, you torque your arm, your wrist, you put some torque on it. And you push the ball, or you push it, or you slice it. And whenever I tried to lighten my right hand grip, always the results are much better. But I wasn't. I said, "Well, I'm not getting the distance I need." But now that I'm, strong enough, and I keep using exercise to increase the strength of my left side, make really strong left side, so that the right side that doesn't need to be so strong, and this prevents the right side from being overpowering on the shot, and this then produces really straight shots. When I did this, tried this, my shots were just, every shot was straight. There was no slicing at all, and no pushing at all, hardly no pushing. When I fine-tune it, it just goes straight. It just goes straight. I said, oh my gosh, I've found the holy grail of golf. That and now engaging the core, those two together is really the holy grail of golf. Never really talked about, especially the grip thing. But rarely do you hear all golf, they say, stay loose, stay relaxed. No. That's all wrong. Engage your core. And I've been doing that in life with all sorts of stuff, carrying heavy loads. I remember, oh, I need to engage my core. As soon as I do it, I feel stable, I feel strong, like I'm not going to hurt myself. And it's a mental thing. You actually tense up your whole core muscles, all your stability muscles. You intentionally tighten them. And then you really feel like you can't fall, like you're really strong. It's amazing what happens. So you can go a lifetime with never doing that, thinking that you're not supposed to do that, and then you change, suddenly change, and the light goes on, and you say, I've got it. So don't think that just because you get older you can't learn new tricks. You can teach an old dog new tricks. You most certainly can. If you keep using faith, hindsight, faith, hindsight, faith. You keep working on that. Results, faith, result, faith. And you will suddenly discover simple, easy stuff that you've never even tried before. And so engage the core. intentionally make sure, and don't try to just loosely grip with the right hand. That's what the swing coaches say. That's nonsense, because you're going to tighten up again. Especially when you want to hit it hard, you most certainly are going to suddenly grip tightly with your right hand, and that will torque your wrist. When you tighten up your wrist, it torques all your muscles contract in your arm, your whole right side contract, and that actually shortens your whole arm. When you contract, you pull back a little bit. When you're loose, you're extended. Now if you tighten everything up, the muscles contract, it shortens the muscle. So when you do that, your wrist, you shorten it, it causes your wrist to turn, and that opens the club face. And that's why you push the shots, because you're contracting the right side. So they always say, well, stay loose and relaxed with your right side, or if you're lefty, with your left side. But who can do that when you're tense out and you're facing this shot where you have to just rip it? For sure you're going to tense up your right side. For sure. 100% you will. Unless you're a freak, a mental freak, you know, that you can keep everything loose and still give 100% effort. You know, then you're like a super pro, like Tiger Woods or something, that you know, just is able to keep all the muscles synced perfectly and not tighten up. Well, because his whole life, all he's done is hit the golf ball, and so he can stay, you know, they can stay that loose under all conditions, even when they're trying to max out a shot. But even then, you see under pressure, they push, what do? They push their shots. They push them. You see that like on the 18th hole of a major open, you may think, oh, they've got it. You know, easy shot into the green. No. Because they're super hyped up, super amped up, super nervous, and they're gripping everything too tightly. And what happens is that they trust their strong side, their right side comes in. They trust this. I got to use it. I got to use it for this shot. They tense up and tighten up the right side. That contracts everything. And what happens? Here comes the shot. They say, oh, looks like he's pushed up a little bit. Hold on, ball. Hold on. Oh, my gosh. He pushed it into the right rough. Push it into the right rough. And now you're chipping out of heavy right rough to try to make par on the final hole to win the U.S. Open. And guess what? You run the ball by 12 feet. Now you've got a 12-footer coming back, and now you're gripping the putter even tighter and trusting the right side. When you grip the putter too tight with the right side, what happens? Oh my gosh, you push your shot a little bit too far right. It burns the right edge. Bogey. You know, you lose the U.S. Open. Just like that. That's what happens. Whereas, so if you take intentionally, if they took their right index finger and thumb off of the grip entirely, it's not even touching the grip, it's the whole like this, they can't, tighten up that much when you're trying to keep this open like this. You can't really tighten up in the same way you can normally do. And the reflex, the tightening up reflex doesn't happen. It doesn't happen. It voids the tightening up reflex. Just like wow voids the mentally tightening up reflex, of mentally tightening up. You don't mentally contract. You already have all wisdom right here already. No need to contract. No need to tighten up. Pretty great stuff. How are we doing here? Minute 44. An hour 44. Well, there's our 144. There's our 144. And it's going to be 144.44 right now. Boom. 144. 144 days. Count from May 1st. And it gets you to Rosh Hashanah. Through Rosh Hashanah, I believe, with the 21st of September. I think it's the 21st. Yeah. And so completing that puts you right on the 22nd. Which is the cusp of this 22nd, 23rd. So, boom, 144 keeps coming up. 44, 144, 44, 144. I think if you start from January 1st to September that week, I think it's 44 weeks. 44 weeks, I believe. No, that can't be right. That cannot be right. Get it? Maybe it is. Or from Christmas. No. I think if you start January 1st, it's 44 weeks. Well, so 52 weeks in there. No, that's not right, because that's only 8 more weeks. And 8 more weeks from that week, if you count September, October, and November, would be 8 more weeks. So that's not quite right. So what is it exactly? Is it the 21st of January? There's 42 weeks when the intensive started. That may be what it is, right? That may be that when this intensive started, which is January 21st. I don't have my calendar with me here, but so that would be 3 more weeks. So exactly sure how to count that up, but that would be then 6 plus 3, 9 weeks. Does that quite get through? I don't know how that works. No, 8 plus 3 is 11, 11, 11, 11 weeks, huh? Maybe 12. No, I have to go back and look at it. It's there. It's there. I mean, the synchronicity is there. It's really there. And maybe the Holy Spirit says, "Don't worry about it. Don't worry about it. Yawn it away." Certainly, the 144 days is there. If you take from May, it's 4 months, and then 4 weeks. If you to 23rd would be the sort of the end and the start of the of that 44th, that 4 months and 4 weeks, 44. So that would work that way. 4 months would be April, May, June, July, August. Those are the 4 months. And then if you apply 4 weeks, first week of September, second week, third week, and then the start of the fourth week would be right on that cusp of the 23rd, like that. So that would be 4 months and 4 weeks doing it that way. Both 144 days and 4 months and 4 weeks. So maybe that's it. If you start May 1st, you have both 144 days and 4 months and 4 weeks. How about that? To the 23rd, like that. To that time frame there. We're not sticking it directly on the 23rd. So there you go. There's the powerful synchronicity of it. With Jesus coming back to the world April 30th, in the evening between April 30th, that night between the April 30th and May 1st. So we'll start on May 1st. You have that perfect synchronicity of 144 and 44, leading right to that time frame of the 23rd of September, the basic time frame right there. You know, give or take, 3 days on one side, 3 days on the other, that kind of thing. Give or take it a week, right? Takes us back to Rosh Hashanah on what, the 20th or 21st? 21st, start of fall, right there in the 20th, maybe. So we have this powerful time frame there, really powerful. And yet we have this powerful tool now that will prepare us properly, for sure. I feel that the opportunity to be prepared is right in front of us here with this leverage now that I'm seeing more and more and more and more, this leverage. Oh my gosh. We in spirit seeing it. Spirit seeing it, saying, "Oh, this is great." Wow. Wow. As we head smoothly, I'm just checking to make sure this can tape long time smoothly. It can, it really can. I could even take this, I could take the laptop and using a cigarette lighter, keep the engine of a vehicle on, and using a plug-in, a power strip plugs in the cigarette lighter, and then has plugs to plug in a regular two-forked or three-forked electrical plug connection. You can plug that in and then just run an extension cord, 100 feet if I need to anywhere I'd want to power the laptop, and then have this external hard drive like this, and then I could literally record for as long as I wanted to using any background I wanted to. So that's very doable, actually. I mean, it's like, hey, I might even try that. I don't know where I could do that, but, you know, God will show the way, right? That's very possible. To do on-site recording using this program. And that way, you know, the problem with my camera is it only takes 20-minute segment or 28-minute segments, and then I have to edit them together. And YouTube only allows you to edit 1 hour long. So, and plus, when it stops, you don't know when it stops, and then you have to time yourself for 28 minutes, and then with the GoPro, you can go about 2.5 hours before the battery runs out. But then you have massive files, because each one is really high res. I could do a lower res probably on it with the GoPro. But then you have to edit them all together too. Same thing. It only takes like about 8 minutes of video before it reaches 3.8 gigabytes or something. So that's not feasible. It's not feasible. But YouTube will allow you to upload a video of any length, really. As far as I know, I've uploaded one that was like 9 hours, and it uploaded that. It will allow that. So this setup, I could do taping outdoors anywhere that an extension cord will go, and people won't trip on it. Can't have a lot of people running around. Oh, I tripped on the cord, you know. I could do that, but I don't know where I could do that. Or, let me see, how can I do this? I do have an external battery pack, but how could I power? I don't have a way to go from that to power this computer. Bummer. A cigarette lighter to a USB would do it. I don't know. I have to figure out, how do I power a computer off an external battery pack? There's no USB power in thing for this computer. Let me see, what is this? USB to a double, I might be able to go USB to a double connection here. I'll look on Amazon to do that. That way I could power the computer off of this external power. I'd be totally portable then. I'll have to see if I can find that kind of connector. But I imagine that the computer takes a lot of power, so it might, I don't know how long the battery pack would last. But it might last for 3 hours or 2-3 hours for sure. And I say, why don't you just use your battery pack of the computer? Well, it's worn out. As far as I know, I don't know how long it would last. But yeah, I could even do it that way. Just, why don't you just use the battery pack for your laptop? It gets worn out over time. It's expensive to replace them. But I could also do it that way, couldn't I? Oh well, you never know what will happen. I might do that. I'll see how long this battery pack is good for. Just run it off the computer battery pack. Or fix up an external battery pack somehow. And just do live taping somewhere. I might do that. That might be the next step I do, actually. Okay, that's a good idea, something to motivate me. How come I won't run off an external battery pack? I don't know. Just, they weren't designed for that. Of course, the battery pack is really large, right, for a laptop. It's very large. So I think a computer takes a lot of juice. I don't think you could last very long off an external battery pack. Or I could just use a camera and do some live taping, and it'd be like, you know, splice two together. It'd be like, you know, an hour, about an hour of taping, and that would be fine too, right? Just forget the whole laptop thing. Forget it. Forget it. Don't even bring all that stuff. But if for a longer one, I'd have to do it that way. Yeah, I'm getting some ideas here. Getting some ideas for the next phase, the next phase. And I could edit stuff in, beautiful scenery and stuff into the like a half an hour of intense wow practice, and then a half an hour edited in for, you know, beautiful scenery or something interesting. Keep it interesting. That's possible, right? It's possible. I could do that. I could do that. Yeah. And maybe an hour is enough for the mixture. Maybe I can have these longer videos and then some shorter ones, like an hour. But you really want to keep your attention on your practice for the next 6 months, so it doesn't wander elsewhere. You don't want to have short videos, really. That's stupid. Say, I want to finish this in 10 minutes and get back to what? You know, we already have what we're seeking. We already have it. So why are we seeking something else? We don't want time to seek something else. We want this time to go as fast as possible with our attention only on the wow. So we want the next 6 months to really go fast. And what did you do? I spent just full stop in the wow. Wow. I spent time with the answer for all time, the all time answer. I spent time with that. That's all I did. And you know what? That'd be the best thing you could ever do. Best thing anyone can do for the next 6 months. So I'll see if I can, the GoPro, if I can put it on like low res and get the clips longer. I think I can. I think I can do that. And that's really portable. And the battery lasts for 2.5 hours, and I think it just keeps taping, whereas my other camera stops at 28 minutes. So I could do it with a GoPro, although, you know, well, yeah, I can. I can change the view to narrow field. I can do that instead of wide angle, and so it looks realistic. I can do that, or I can make it look all cosmic by having a fisheye thing. Yeah. Yeah. And I can tape different segments at different places. Minimal of stuff, minimum of stuff needed. And if it's not raining, if in order to tape the audio, I have to have the case open. So I got an open case and put that on a battery pack so it won't run out of batteries. The batteries last a long time anyway. So I mean, that's very easily doable with a minimum of equipment, actually. Very minimum. Wow. And carry the other camera on too. So I don't know. The only problem with the GoPro, I can't see. Well, I mean, if I mean where I am in the, well, I can't see the other camera either, but I can at least compose it because it's got a viewfinder. The GoPro, no viewfinder, no back screen, no digital, you know, LED screen to see. It's got a viewfinder. No viewfinder. Does it have view? No viewfinder. You just have to hold it there and hope it, you know, gets what you want. But I can figure that out, the distance and stuff. I can figure that out. To do some tests. I already did some tests. I think it's like about, I don't know, what is it? 6 feet or something away, about my body length away, is a good composition. But maybe closer for the audio. Actually, I need to be closer. It doesn't have any audio input, neither does my camera. I can't plug a microphone in. I don't think I can do that with a camera, so the audio won't be so good. But you know what do we need the audio so much audio for? It's just wow. You know, I can just say, hey, wow. We're practicing the wow here, and just give some pointers. It's time for wow practice, everyone. Yeah. So there's a different style than what you'll see other people, others offering in the world. It's a different style. Yeah, but it's the style that I'm able to do, and do it right. Do it right. So you want a style that's done right, right now. It's do or die time. Simple commitment. Simple style. Simple commitment. Boom. Next 6 months. I'm doing it. That's all there is to it. It's already done deal because I decided I'll do it. So I'm amping up for the next 6 months. We'll see what the Dharma Kings do for us. They might do a lot for us. But I'm not getting my expectations one way or the other. It's just wow. Whatever they do for us is already done, and it's wow. So I already have the reaction to what they're going to do, which is wow, right? I already have the reaction to the entirety of the future, as long as the future lasts, the idea of time, conditioned existence. I already have the final reaction that I'll have to all of it, which is wow. That's it. Oh, what time is it? It's getting to be... Ah. Back still gets sore when you swing a golf club. I don't care how fit you are. It still gets sore. Kelly Slater has said he's had a sore back for the last 3 or 4 years. He says, I might not be able to surf much longer. You know, it's really hurting my back. I said, Kelly, it's not surfing that's hurting your back. It's golfing. Okay? If you want to stay on the tour longer, just stop golfing, you know? It's golfing that's killing your back, but he won't do that. No, I did. I quit golfing for 2 years now. My back's been fine. Just stop golfing and your back will be fine. Now, surfing does put strain on your back, yes, but not like golf. Golf is the worst. It is the worst for your back. No doubt about it. That's why Tiger Woods had all these back surgeries. His back is toast at this point. At this point, of course, everything is completely in the now, so he could always choose for it to be better. But, his, you know, all these surgeries he's had, boy, his back just spasms up. He can't function anymore. Can't function. Of course, if he did full stop in the wow, it'd be a different story. It'd be a different story. He might discover a new swing. He says, oh my gosh, this works. This really works. Yeah. Now, he may not be able to compete on the tour, like, you know, because the guys there, they really bash it. You know, I mean, they grip it and rip it. They might be able to play really good golf without pain. You know, that's quite possible. He doesn't need to do anything anywhere on the tour anymore anyway. He doesn't need to, you know, add to his legacy, really. It's already on Mount Rushmore. It's already there. It's good enough. You know, it's good enough. He did his thing. It's good enough. It's done. And maybe time to walk away. Say, let's do full stop on the wow practice instead. Forget about trying to add to some legacy there. I already know my legacy is what? Wow. All legacies are what? Wow. All legacies that will ever appear in conditioned existence. The sum total of all those legacies, we already have it here, and it's wow. That's it. I already have it. So we have our legacy. We have our perfect legacy. We have our total legacy. We have the totality of conditioned existence already here right now, which is wow. Right in our mind, we have it. And the reaction to that is wow. Is wow also. Don't forget that. We already have the whole response to all miracles, all healing, all whatever. Wow. So even if there's infinite miracles that take place in the future, conditions exist, we already have the sum total of all of that, which is wow. So that's the ultimate miracle right there. That's the ultimate time-saving device is wow. It's the ultimate miracle. Because all miracles are only for the purpose of saving delay. That's it. And trying to fixate the mind is just, we're just delaying the inevitable, realizing that we can't. So the ultimate miracle is wow. Full stop in the wow is the ultimate miracle. Jesus said, this is A Course in Miracles, and thanks to A Course in Miracles, I was able to get to the wow practice, which is the ultimate time-saving miracle of them all. And the sight is starting to hit me. I mean, it's really going north in a big hurry now, isn't it? Yeah, it is. Time to start taping outside now. And so we will see how that goes. You know, if my knee can... Knee, you know, you need to be ready. You needed to be ready. And it's not quite ready, but it will be. It will answer the bell. In some way, somehow, it'll answer the bell. You know, have to answer the bell. Got to. Say, knee, you got to answer the bell. All right. So, another day of fasting for me. You know what I've been eating today? Akbak. crackers, AK-MAK Akmaks. They're very good. Just a little bit of sesame seeds on this real hard, brittle kind of, with bubbly, hard bread. You know, it's very ancient bread. Just flat bread with these bubbles in them. And my secret to the Akmak, my Akmak secret is I smear some butter on them. I have this, you know, cube of butter, and I kind of rub the Akmak crackers across the top of the butter and get some butter on them, and just eat a little bit of butter. That's all I need, just that little bit of butter. It gives you some fat. You need some fat in your diet. So it's very important. If you're going to fast, you're going to diet, you have to keep getting some natural fat, whether it's olive oil or you know, butter is a really good fat, actually. They used to say it was terrible. Well, because people were just floating everything in butter. You know, too much of anything. But butter, some good butter, you know, it a little bit of butter in your diet, I believe, is a good thing. And I put some butter in my diet, I really do. And I get, you know, oil from peanut butter. But just Akmak and a thin little bit of butter on them. And that's all I've been eating yesterday and today, along with a smoothie of tart cherry juice, Odwalla Green Monster drink, which is all this good green stuff, broccoli, algae, mango, pears. I mean, it's just all this fruit and vegetables blended up, and it's really good. Mix that with tart cherry juice and fresh squeezed OJ, and then chocolate protein powder and blueberries. That's it. So frozen blueberries, scoop of chocolate protein powder, about a third tart cherry juice, fresh orange juice, and green Odwalla Green Monster drink. That's it. I didn't put anything else in it. Didn't even put the kale in it. I got lazy this morning. I took a day off from the kale. But you can throw kale in as well. But the Green Monster drink has a lot of kale in it too. So just that and Akmak crackers with some butter on them. That's been my diet. And I'm going to push it through today too. I'm going to stick with it. I'm not going to eat any dinner. I'm going to just be really disciplined here and just go with Akmak crackers. And I'm really interested to see what the scale is going to show in the morning. Really, if you're a dieter, you know how important that scale is in the morning. When you're really pushing it like this, I mean, you're just looking for a good score. I hope the judges give me a good score. Akmak innovation. You know, we're giving a 9.83, you know, for Akmak butter innovation. Come on, that's the way to innovate with your diet, with your smoothie too. We love the combo of the smoothie and the Akmak crackers. 9.3. Get you into the finals. Power move. That's a power diet. I should have bought more Akmaks. I don't know why. I was just in the market. I'm stupid. I got to go back and get more Akmaks. Because I'm running out of the other boxes. But there's not much to them. You know, that's the great thing about it. Not much to them. So I can feel the pounds melting away. Get down into 167, but that's like a holy grail. I mean, I never thought I could. That was just a distant. Like, are you kidding me? 167. I don't know. I will feel elated if I get to 167. I will just feel elated. I mean, what, you know, determination to stick with it, because I keep going back up. You know, you get low and then you start going back up, and you have to discipline yourself to go back down again. And so you take two steps forward, then one step back. That's how it is dieting for me. And that's really tough, because when you start eating again, you're going to go back up. And then you have to hold the line and not let it get away from you. So then, and then you make another push later and you get even lower. That's how it goes. That's how it goes. It's not easy. Dieting is not easy. Keeping it off is so difficult. For me, the tortoise, you know, I'm the tortoise, you know, almost zero metabolism, don't burn anything. Like, it doesn't matter if I exercise, I still don't burn anything. It's nuts. Environmentally friendly, I'm a very environmentally friendly being, to say the least. I don't go anywhere, I don't do anything, and I don't eat anything. my consumption is very minimal consumption of everything. So you talk about my carbon footprint, it's like, you know, super duper low. Relatively speaking. I mean, if you're living, you know, in the woods hunting and that's it in a little cabin. I mean, but you're still burning, you know, fire to keep you warm, heating the planet up. But living in California, you don't have, you know, use too much heat, but we use AC. So, you know, but anyway, relatively speaking, just this unbelievably low carbon footprint for my own being. But, you know, you have to work, you have to do other stuff, you know, then that, you know, that adds up to it, right? It does. But as far as being environmentally friendly, I am super environmentally friendly. In other words, I walk the walk. I don't talk the talk. I don't worry about, you know, blah, 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 this. There's so much rhetoric, environmental rhetoric. I just say, you know what, my conscience is clean on that one, entirely, entirely clean. I don't eat any meat whatsoever. I'm really now at this point, I'm a vegan. Well, butter, I'm not a vegan because I use butter. There you go. I'm a near vegan. Okay, I'm a near vegan. I understand vegans, you don't even need dairy products, so you don't need all the cattle to eat all the grass and heat up the environment and all that kind of stuff. So they're even more squeaky clean. But I don't use that much butter. Pretty minimal. Don't even eat eggs. Yogurt, I stopped eating yogurt. So maybe butter's my only sin. But a little bit of butter's okay. I don't want to be, you know, like, hey, look at me, I'm a vegan. No. So this, I'm a vegan, except I use butter, so that's good. I don't have to call myself a vegan, because that's trying to be a little bit pompous, you know. Oh, I'm a vegan. No, I'm just a vegetarian. People say, are you vegan? I said, well, you know, kind of, but, you know, just I'm just a vegetarian. Like that. They say, oh, cool. They're cool with that. If you're a vegetarian, they're cool with that. Everybody's cool with it. Oh, yeah, my sister's a vegetarian, too. My friend's a vegetarian. Oh, yeah, that's good. Is everybody, yeah, we need to eat less meat. Yeah, everybody says that. We need to eat less meat, but they don't do it. They don't do it. This is the whole thing about they're not dharmic. They don't actually do it. I mean, I actually have a super dharmic diet. Very, what do you call sattvic? I have a super sattvic diet because I've actually done it. Easy to talk, difficult to do. To be dharmic, you have to be a doer. You have to actually do the discipline. You know, I literally don't watch television at all. I literally don't listen to the radio. I literally don't look at any magazines. I did look at one thing in a golf magazine, but other, you know, occasionally like that, super rare, super duper rare. One page, Tiger Woods, 97 Masters. I said, I want to see this, and it was pretty amazing. But that's just the anomaly that proves the discipline, right? Yeah, absolutely. And we're not trying to be pompous saying not even one time. There might be one time, okay? Whatever. That doesn't ruin it for you, right? It doesn't make you non-dharmic. You know, the people are trying to be perfect. That itself is non-dharmic because you're putting too much energy into being perfect, okay? Where it could be better expended elsewhere. So for me, you know, if 99.9%, no TV, no news, no newspaper, no internet news, no radio, no block the world out, 99.9%. You know what? That's being dharmic. Trying to be 100% is actually non-dharmic. You're working against yourself. You're trying to prove a point instead of just allowing yourself to be helped towards the ultimate goal. The goal isn't to be perfectly dharmic in terms of your practice. It's to be really 99.9% and then put your attention is on the goal, you know, practicing and reaching the goal. Peace of God is be upon us. That's the goal, which is inexpressible. You see that, you know. So keep that in mind. You don't have to be absolutely perfect, but try to be virtually so. Try to be virtually so. Okay, almost. But really, I've not turned on the radio or the television. And occasionally, like Facebook, they have the news, three news articles on the right side. So I glance at those, you know. Is the world still here? Oh, it's still here. Good. Okay. I don't put my cursor over them so it pops up. I just, you know, Trump this. You know, like, ah, okay, whatever. Still alive. Good. You know, as long as he's in the news, that means he's still alive, which is great. I haven't gotten to him yet. Again, familiarity with tradition, what we're used to, doesn't work. Great. No intrigue there. No intrigue. You know, he'll do his thing. businessman thing, you know. He'll do his thing. And say, oh yeah, okay. Been there, done that. Doesn't work. Not really interested. But I'll stick with that over innovation any day now. And again, that is the crucial error. If we are right thing to do, and if we make the error of getting intrigued by innovation, back on the path of death and failure, for sure, for sure. And I'm not interested in anybody, okay, any person, anybody, or any of that stuff. That's all, you know, been there, done that. Special relationship, not interested in any of that. To be aware that doesn't work, and just stick with that whole that doesn't workness. So, yeah, I'll stop being so anti that now, because I realize that's effective, you know. Same old thing, you know. Same old, same old. Okay. That's better than seeking for innovation, that is for sure. Because that's when you really go to hell. I've experienced that. Because there's this massive innovation out there, right? Constant about my looks, my gender, my looks, my interests, you know, what attracts me, what do I find attractive? Constantly innovating on that. It's just, you know, what a joke, and what an unnecessary delay all that is. If you just get a traditional, like for a man, traditional female, say, look at me, aren't I shapely? You know, well, yeah, and aren't you boring? You know, good. I'll take boring over innovation anytime. Boring is good now. Okay, boring is the new, is the, is what, is the new hipness. Boring is hip. Boring is cool. Boring is really cool right now. Go back to the same old boring stuff. That is the ticket. Because then we can turn our attention to the wow, which is the ultimate innovation of all. It's all innovation. It's the ultimate, final, total innovation, is this wow practice. Don't need any of that other innovation whatsoever. None of it. I don't need any technical innovation at all. I really don't. Doesn't even interest me. I know I have the next big thing. I don't have we don't have the next big thing. We have the biggest thing that there will ever be, the final big thing, the ultimate big thing, the sum total of all big things. We already have the sum total of all big things, all innovation. We have the sum total of it right here, which is just the wow. Full stop on the wow. Wow. Gotta feel great about that. Have I used up my disk space? No, there's still 1,849 and a half gigabytes left. Okay. All right, so that's about divided by four. So I could do like 400 of these videos. That'll get us through to September 23rd, right? Do even more, 450. 450 of these videos for something like that, or four. Yeah, 450 of these videos. But who knows, I might do that. But I could just buy another one. Let's just buy another one. And they would do 450 more. I'll never, yeah. I'm just letting this run just to see how good, and it is flawless. I want to find out when it gets to 4 megabytes, does it keep going? This is what I need to find out. Sorry, 4 gigabytes. Will it, and we're getting close to that. I have to find out if it just keeps on trucking, or will it cut off at four gigabytes here? Because the memory cards tend to cut off at 4 gigabytes. The old one, this new one didn't cut off, but it's having problems now of its own. So we'll just see. We'll just hang in there for a little while. Hang in there, because why not? We got what we been seeking for. The ultimate prize. We already have the ultimate prize, the total prize. We've won the total prize. We're total winners. Wow. We have the wow. We're total winners, already total winners. As soon as you have start practicing the wow, you're a total winner. You just have to wow that fact. You say, oh my gosh, I'm a total winner. Wow. And it's true. And you can spend the next six months wowing that. Don't have 6 sex months, have 6 wow months. Okay. Yeah, you don't, no more sex. Forget it. Okay. Forget it. It's boring. Sum total of all sensuality is wow. So sum total of everything is wow. So, you know, give it a rest for 6 months. Totally. The sex, the drugs, the rock and roll. Give it a 6 month rest. Just do it. Just do it. Otherwise, you're just casting more delay in front of yourself. You're just paving the road of delay for yourself. The road, our road is already completely paved. Our road to salvation is already completely paved. Wow is the completed road. All the way to total liberation. Our road is already totally paved. All the signs are there, the markings are there. Perfect freeway. Totally paved in immaculate condition. All we have to do is just go down that freeway. Don't need to take any side trips whatsoever. Boring is in. Really boring is really in. So stay with your boring friend or spouse or significant other. That's great. Stay with them. Do not try to innovate at all. Except for the wow. Again, the wow is the ultimate innovation. Our road is already paved with gold. All the way. It's paved in perfect, pure gold all the way to final liberation. It's already perfectly paved. Wow. Try that for innovation. Try that for innovation. Try that for success. So we already have the total treasure we're seeking. And then, of course, reality is beyond anything we can say. So there's no point in having any level of confusion about the term total treasure. As long as we're talking, using words total treasure, it's the wow is our total treasure. That we found the total treasure. We found it. We have it. And we just have to wow that fact. Oh my gosh, I'm totally enriched. I'm totally blessed with total treasure. I hit the ultimate lottery. I got everything from it. I won everything. Wow is winning everything. So people wonder, why am I so confident? Because I knew I've already won everything. I know I've already won everything. So I came into this world so confident. People just said, this is impossible. Nobody can be like this. Nobody can be so confident. But I knew this practice technique is, you've already won everything. So why shouldn't you be totally confident? There's not, you, loss has ended for you. There's no more loss you can experience at all. So insecurity gone. So, right? But we have to wow this fact that we're done with insecurity forever. So we don't have insecurity, but we still have this wow jitters. So I'm not levitating yet, you know, but getting there. If I keep losing weight, I might just levitate. I might float away. I might just keep losing weight until I just levitate. Don't need to. Practice the wow enough and you'll levitate. Or you may not even need to levitate. The whole world actually levitates. You'll levitate. You know, why levitate yourself? Why not just levitate the entire world? That's actually easier. It's true. I know that's kind of a reversal of Ramana's thing. Just wear shoes instead of trying to clean the whole world up. But actually, it's easier to levitate the entire world than to levitate yourself. That's why Jesus says, free the entire world first, and then you'll realize that you're free as well. Because the burden of the world is gone. If the entire world is levitated, the whole burden of the world is off of you, isn't it? realizing you have power over the entire world. So why could you be insecure? The fact that you prove, when you levitate yourself, you're not proving you have power over the entire world, really, but in a roundabout way. But if you levitated the entire world, you realize, oh my gosh, the whole world really is just a projection of my own thoughts. I really do have this power. So levitate the entire world. I don't know what that's like, but we'll find out. What is it like to levitate the whole world? Peace of God probably is what you experience, right?
How are we doing? We're doing great.
Even if it ends now, that's fine. It's been an amazing video. My wife told me, go tape. I said, I already taped. Oh, I thought you were taping. So I said, okay, I'll go tape. How about that? Your wife telling you to go tape? God, what are you doing in here? Go tape. That's pretty cool. So your spouse saying, hey, go practice the wow. What are you doing? You don't do anything. Go practice the wow. Come on. Hey. Okay. I thank you very much. I will. Don't have to twist my arm too hard to do that. So if you've got a friend or a spouse, you know, that's like that, well, that's great. Boring, but great, right? You want boring. Boring's cool. What are you doing? Just go tape. Yeah, that's all I do. Well, keep doing it. Oh, yeah. Don't need to innovate too much, right? Now, I don't know if innovating and taping is a good idea or not. Maybe I should just stay here with this boring kind of taping. Holy Spirit will tell me what to do. Maybe I don't need to innovate with the taping. Because many just listen to the, you know, maybe just listen to the audio anyway. Just rip an MP3 off of this video and then just listen to it while you're driving. So it doesn't really matter where the locale is at all. It's the content anyway. So some are that maybe that way, and some want to see the visuals also. I don't know. I haven't had much feedback on anything, actually. Maybe, you know, the Spirit was saying, maybe he'll stop if he doesn't have any feedback. No, didn't work. Didn't work. How's the audio? Is it still recording? Let me check the audio. How's the audio? Checking it. It's good. It's very good. It's great. It's perfect. And we're almost up to the 4 gig, so I'll find out very soon. And either is one way or the other. Either way is good, right? Either way is perfect. I'm still nervous about the surfing. Because of the semifinals are coming up. So basically, you can have one of those four surfers, Mac Williamson or something. What's his name? Owen Wilson. Is it Owen Wilson there? Medina. Owen Wilson. Florence. John Florence is there. So four of the big surfers are there, actually. Really. I mean, yeah. You got four heavyweights up there. Four heavyweights. So it should be great semifinals and a great final. And, you know, of course I want Florence to win. I think he's the best surfer. He's the best surfer to watch, for sure. Medina, you know, it's just, you know, the goofy footers just snap and turns off the lip. Well, he can do a lot of good aerials, too. So, you know, he's good, but he's not as good as he thinks he is, actually. His opinion of himself is that he's the best in the world, he's going to break all Kelly Slater's records and all that stuff. He's not that good. He's not. Slater's way better. And Florence is better, too, as far as just being dialed in to surfing in the wave. Medina's more of a showman type, acrobatic showman type. And, you know, that's fun too, but just see someone who's just, you know, has this overall game with being innovating at the right time and know what to do in the right place. That's what Slater's so good is, what is the wave giving me? And how can I innovate here and do something beautiful with what the wave is giving me? And just keep stringing that together, you know. It's better than power surfing. It's better than power surfing. Knowing what to do at the right time, the right thing at the right time, that's the best surfer. Well, that's Kelly Slater. And John Florence is right there too. He's getting there. He's getting there. Not as good as Slater yet, but he's getting there. And, you know, he's an awesome tube rider. Awesome. So it's all good. They're all great. It'll be really interesting to see the semis and the finals. Really interesting to watch that. I hope, I'm rooting for Florence to start out the year great, and that's going to put a lot of interest in the year. It may be Florence against Medina in the finals. It very, very well may be that. And that's a heavyweight final. Those are the two guys that you think are, you know, fighting for the championship this year. So starting it out with, you know, Battle Royal, and hopefully Florence gets royally tubed and gets like a 10 or something. But hey, I hope they both surf great, you know? Absolutely. Whoever wins, you let the best man win, and, you know, just like surf unbelievably well. It's an eye-opener, their talents. I mean, Slater, just the way he's able to keep his balance on these turns that he does, he turns back so radically into the wave, and the wave hits him, and somehow, you know, he comes out still with his balance is, you know, just wow. Same with Florence. I mean, they're like literally leaning back into the water, sitting in the water, kind of, and allowing the wave to push them back up on their board. You know, stuff like that is really, you know, it's quite amazing to see the agility and balance that they have. But they know how to do that. I see how they do it is the push of the wave. They use that to push them back up onto their feet, onto the boards. They lay back into the wave. They literally lay their body back into the wave and keep the board under their feet with their feet. Most of us would panic and fall, but no. And then they use the momentum of the wave to just get back on their board. How amazing is that? They know all the tricks. You know, they get their fins loose at the top of the wave, spin the board around like that. Spinners are easy for them. 180, then spinners are easy for them. They can do that no problem. They know all the tricks and they don't fall. I saw a really cool thing recently. What was that? I forgot what it was. Some sort of drift, different types of drifts in sections on top of the white water, on top of the breaking wave. They get up on top and they drift. They do various drifts like that. I think they did it. They kind of reversed, pivoted towards back out to the ocean and got their fins loose in the drift and then snapped back into it or something like that. All sorts of things, but they know exactly what they're doing. They've done it thousands of times. It's knowing when to do what, and decisions, like super quick, immediate decisions, and make it look like it all natural, all flowing. It was like it was all meant to be this way. Like, of course it was meant to be this way. As if the decisions had already been made. You know, that's great surfing. Not overpowering a wave, but stringing all these right decisions together and flowing them all together like it was just meant to be. Like, this is how you surf the wave. Like a great singer, same way. Like Dion, I didn't realize that some of the songs he did, like the Drifters did them before. Like, what was that? Some of his hits, you know, he was covering songs. But he sang them. They say, you don't even know that it's a cover. I don't know who did, what was that? One of his songs, Ruby. I think Ruby is a cover. One of his biggest hits is a cover from the Drifters, I believe. Either the Platters or the Drifters. But nobody knows that because he sang it so great. People think that must be his song. It must be his song. But it was actually a cover. So the really greatest singers can cover songs and everybody thinks it must be their song. George Jones, whatever he covered, you'd swear that must be his song. That nobody else can do that song. He does it perfect. But it was actually covers. So same thing with surfing. You want to make it seem like that wave, that's exactly the way the wave was supposed to be surfed perfectly. You know, that's exactly what, rather, you know, that's give that impression that there's no other way that wave could have been surfed. So that's a 10, right? There's no other way you could have surfed that wave. That you surfed it perfectly the way it was supposed to be surfed. That's the impression you want to give the judges, unless the judges are into power surfing, and this went past the 4 gigabytes, so we're good. Unless they're into, you know, just, you know, real, just, you know, how well can you rip the wave apart? You know, if they're into that, then it's a different story. But I prefer to have the wave surfed, give you the feeling that that's exactly the perfect the way this wave was meant to be surfed. And that's really the top, that's top-notch 10 territory when you do that. But these days, you do some power aerial and you get a 10. And it's like, now don't give a 10 to that. You know, give him a 9, not a 10. Like this one guy, Italo, had a 10. He just did one aerial. He took off, powered up, and went into this insane aerial, like a 540 or something. He got a 10. Give him 9.8. Or 9.5 or something, not a 10, because that's the only thing you did on the wave. don't give 10s for that. That's not a perfect ride. If you did that aerial plus rode out the wave, everything else, you know, then maybe, and it was all just in the flow of it, maybe, you know, that would be a 10. But they want to reward innovation, like doing a 540, so they gave him a 10. I understand that, but that's an anomaly, isn't it? You know, as a rule, give the 10s for a perfect ride. And the wave needs to be juicy, you know, for that to happen, you have to have a, you know, a very juicy wave for a 10. In other words, it seems to be forcing the surfer into all these moves. Like here's the wave saying, I'm dictating how you're surfing me. And then the surfer does exactly what the wave is dictating beautifully, then that's a 10. Gives that impression. The surfer gives that impression. One with the flow. One with the no. Staying in the now. One with the flow. Slater's so good mentally staying in the now, in the flow, that I love that way of surfing. It just, that's why he's the greatest of all time. He just keeps stringing it together like it's all just one flow, and it's just meant to be. I can see that and say, wow, that's really very, very great surfing, and it's not so easy. Have to really come out of every move, you have to come out of it with anticipating, you know, the wave of the next move quickly. You know, give the impression that it's all one seamless flow, where in fact it's not quite that, but the artistry of surfing is to give that impression. So as you come out of a move, make sure you're coming out of the move in such a way that it opens the door for the next move, to make it seem like you already had it in your mind, you already saw it, as if you'd seen the entire wave before it even happened. So you already know that this is what I'm going to do in the next part of the wave, even though you don't know, because you're coming out, you're blind to it as you're doing some turn. You come out, but you see it so quickly that it's all a seamless flow. That's the trick to great surfing. Great surfing, that is really it. It's not just ripping snaps off the top. That's not it at all. And I think they're rewarding that way too much. Way too much. That's a no-brainer. Anyone can do that. It's just athletic, but it doesn't have the genius in it at all. Doesn't. No genius to it. So there you go. You get an advanced surf knowledge here. She called Kelly Slater genius of all time. GOAT stands for genius of all time. Of just on the fly, shifting gears on the fly. And it's all smooth shifting work. It's like, holy cow, what a race car driver, you know? Like that, man. Shifting speeds on the fly. I mean, he does these beautiful stall outs. Just boom. It's just so quick. It's just perfect stall at the perfect time. And then accelerate. You know, the speed control going back and forth of everything. Just making it seem like it was all meant to be that way. But, yeah, it's a good robot. Good to watch that. And you get this as a pattern. Like, you expect that. If I ever surf, I'll say, okay, I expect this is how you're supposed to surf. This is the way you surf. Look at the wave like that and practice your moves so that, you know, your balance and everything is ready to flow into the next move, whatever it may be. And have an idea ahead of time, you know, this may be, a wave may be like this. You know, wave knowledge helps a lot. Studying the waves and saying, okay, having some options in your mind, saying, and then, you know, controlling your speed beautifully the whole way. Don't just try to go as fast as you can the whole wave or whatever. You know, just keep your speed control exactly the way you want it to be. Sometimes you want to stall out. Get back in the lip, you know, and stall out, get back in the barrel. If you want to do a floater, maybe. He actually stalled out on a floater. That's what he did. He stalled on a floater. I'd never seen that before. I said, whoa. Because he saw the wave was slowing down in front, so he did a floater, then he stalled out on the floater, and then dropped in, and then did a bottom turn, kind of back, and that helped connect him, you know, with the wave as it set up some more. Stalling on a floater, I don't know how do you stall on a floater? I don't know what he was doing. They could do pretty much anything, but actually, sometimes they fall. When they fall, it's a big surprise. Like what? I didn't know, realize you could fall. How they do that? How they manage to fall? It's almost like they have to try to fall. We're so used to seeing them not fall. Whereas most surfers, well, they're just falling all the time. Falling all the time. I think it's important when you surf to practice not falling and get confident, like, I'm not supposed to fall. And then you bring that with you as you increase your skills. You just get used to, like, I don't fall, you know? Whereas if you're falling all the time, say, oh, I fall all the time, and then you start doing more and more radical maneuvers and just keep falling, and that's your legacy. But just like golf, I think it's better to practice hitting wedge shots, you know, perfect wedge shots, 80 in a row, instead of saying, well, I just hit 10 good ones, so let me go to my driver now, let me go something more difficult. No, keep building your confidence. So you say, I can hit 80 in a row. I can't miss. You should keep building up this confidence, like, you can't miss. I can't miss. I just can't miss. Which is very wowish. I can't miss. And then bring that to the other clubs gradually. I believe, I'm going to try that way, because I believe that's more effective than going to a difficult club to hit and missing on it. And then suddenly all your confidence that you built up, you lose it so quickly on a golf course. You can lose your confidence so quickly. Takes one bad bunker shot and boom, I'm an idiot now. Suddenly I'm an idiot. Takes just one shot and it really dents your confidence out there. But the problem is then it takes one great shot to rebuild it. And when you're searching for that great shot, what happens? You end up hitting a whole bunch of bad shots looking for that one great shot to restore your confidence. So that's why golf becomes so difficult. Way better to just stay within yourself and keep building up your confidence so you don't really hit that one really bad, terrible shot. And so then you don't have to make up for it by one spectacular shot. You see how that's a way, way, way wiser strategy. Don't go for the spectacular shots. Just don't do it. Stay within your repertoire, what you can do well. And keep your confidence really high. And just see how that feels. See how that feels. And if you really get confident, then you can try spectacular shots down the road. And you might make them and you might miss them. But you know that's pretty rare. You don't have to do that very much. And if you miss one, you just say, well, you know, I won't be trying that again for a while. Not really. Just put it behind you, like, immediately. And just keep sticking with what you do well. It's when you get in this negative spiral of too risky, failing, losing confidence, trying the spectacular to regain it. That's, you know, you're going to wipe you out and you're going to quit. So I'm very cautious. I mean, the last time I went to a driving range, just one time in, you know, years, really, I just hit the wedge and the 9-iron. That's it. That's it. I hit the wedge about 80 times. Just dialed it in, so just every shot was great. I said, I'm not hitting anything else. Forget it. I'm going to take this confidence with me. So how do I feel? I feel super confident. So for the last, that's been maybe almost a month since I did that, I've been feeling very confident with golf because I say, hey, I just hit 80 perfect shots, you know, great shots, 80 great shots. The last time I golfed, I hit 80 great shots in a row. So, whereas if I went to the driver and I might have struggled with it, tried to figure something out, I might have hit 30 lousy shots, you know, horrible shots. And then I'd walk away saying, wow, I really stunk with the driver. Terrible. I don't have that fixed at all. And so I've spent the last month like feeling terrible about golf. So you see how that how bad that is? Instead, I spent the last month feeling like, hey, I can golf really well. So I'm just letting the confidence sink in before I even hit another ball. I'm not even interested in hitting another ball at this point because I feel so good about my game. I say the less golf I play, the better I get, the more confident I get, which is true, which is really true. Sometimes you have to take a step back, which I did. I quit. Haven't played since. I quit. Well, I played one tournament, charity. Well, yeah, it was a comp tournament. It was comp, business comp me, just to be with all the guys, camaraderie thing. But other than that, I quit. So I let all the bad memories go, you know, let it go, forgot them. I can't even remember, you know, how I was playing. I can't even remember it. So wipe the slate clean and then start again with these easy shots and just keep building confidence with the easier shots. Build it. That's how I'm going to do it. I don't want to lose confidence again. I can't go through that cycle again. And I want to play on an easy golf course, tell you the truth. I don't want to play in a difficult golf course. I'll lose my confidence, and I don't want to do that. I want to play in a beautiful, easy course and start building some good scores, actually. Start shooting some good scores and say, hey, I'm a pretty good golfer. Look at that score. That's how I want to do it now. This is just really smart. Finally, getting smart. So I won't go to this other, my old home golf course. I won't go there anymore. I said, that's it. I'm done because it's too difficult. It's a confidence killer. It's really one of the most difficult golf courses you could possibly play. It's that difficult, especially when the rough is high and when it gets wet. It's just devastatingly difficult, and it destroys my confidence. So it's not worth going there. It's like, well, if I do good one time there, I'll say, oh, I'm really good. But the next time you go, it'll kill you, you know, and then you lose it all again. So it's not good. It's not good. So I'm looking for a beautiful, easy course. Not super easy, but, you know, not devastatingly difficult at all. It's kind of a nice medium course. Nice resort course. They don't make resort courses too difficult because nobody will come back and play again. So they give you some friendly bailout area. You know, the rough is not too high. The greens, they put the pin places where you can make some putts. The sand is nice. They want you to have a good time. They want you to have a nice score. Okay, so something like that, a nice resort course. Kind of flat. The lies aren't too hilly. You get nice lies, hitting good shots. You say, hey, I'm feeling good today. And then you go back home and you say, you know what? I'd like to go back there again. I really played good golf there. Something like that, right? Smart. I always think they cut the holes bigger at resorts. Really, I do. Because the ball seems to go in the hole more there. I don't know what's going on. I do know they most certainly make sure the lips are not sagging in anywhere. You know, that it's fully compressed to get the full cup rather than, you know, any kind of... Some courses, they seem to be contracted a little bit, actually. But resort courses, they make sure that, they want you to get the ball in the hole. Plain and simple. So that's what I'm looking for. And so good, I have a goal. A beautiful, medium difficult resort course that, you know, I can start building up some good scores on. I need that. I need it. I don't want to go back to terrible scores because I had an off day on a brutal course. Because when you have an off day on a brutal course, you're going to shoot over 100. I mean, if you're not playing well on that course, if the conditions are tough there, you're going to have a trouble breaking 100. Seriously, it's that difficult. And if you're really on, you know, you might be able to shoot mid 80s to low 80s. Other than that, you have to be just extremely good player to do anything other than that there. I mean, to shoot in the 70s there, you have to be just a, total top-notch golfer. Totally top-notch. And again, if you're not on, I've seen top-notch golfers there get destroyed. Just destroyed. Because they were off a little bit. Just destroyed. And I knew these guys, if they went to an easy course, they might shoot par. You know, but they got destroyed there because they were off a little bit. Took a, just tough. That's no fun. That's no fun. Too difficult. Too difficult. So, resort course, resort course, resort course. Here we come. Building up some scores. I want to shoot par eventually. I want to shoot par. Just not under par. My goal is par. That's it. Just shoot par. And see if I can do that. Just shoot par. I don't want to think about shooting under par. No way. Par is good enough for me right now. So, once I get used to being a par, be able to shoot par, well, I don't know, I'm not making any, predictions or anything, but I'm not going to get greedy. I just want par. That's it. That's it. I'll be happy if I'm a scratch golfer. Okay, that'll be fine. Don't get greedy. Just like if your cancer goes in remission, that's good enough. That's par. You're a par golfer. Your cancer's in remission. Let it be. Let it be. Don't try to defeat it and say, not only is it in remission, there's not even any trace of it anymore. It'll never come back. You're getting greedy. You're getting greedy. And it'll come back on you when you do that. Just you say, my cancer's in remission. I'm happy with that. And you see people who are happy with it, It doesn't come back on them, usually. It doesn't. If they just accept that it's in remission. So let's just accept the wow. Just accept the wow. Our insecurity is in remission. We can get to a point where our insecurity will be in total remission. But don't get greedy. Don't get greedy. Just say, that's good enough. That's good enough. And just wow that, it's in total remission. My insecurity is in total remission. Wow. Because as soon as we try to go further than that, we're putting ourselves back into kind of a dualistic thing, like we're trying to defeat something. Because reality cannot be explained in any way, okay? There's nothing, there's no structure to explain. So we can't even explain, total cure. We can't. Really, there's never been anything there to cure in the first place. So it's better to just say it's in total remission. Because anything other than that, you're going to outsmart yourself. For sure. And it'll come back. Insecurity will come back on you. It'll come back on you. Just say, I'm just enjoying the total remission of insecurity at this point. And that's all I'm going to do for the rest of my life here. That's it. Don't get caught up in this game. Well, there's something beyond that. No. Well, for me, I'm going to stick just with this. Thank you very much. Very important to hear this. Very, very important. So there's some teachers that play that one-upsmanship game to say, well, yeah, that's good. You're in total remission, but, now there's another step there. There's more steps beyond that. And as soon as you try to take more steps beyond that, you're back in insecurity, and then suddenly they've one-upped you, and now they're the guru, and you're the needy one, and like that, okay? So we have the wow. That's the guru. The wow is our guru. So just say, the wow is my guru. The Dharma kings are beyond even the guru-ness, you might say. So for us, the wow is our guru. And say, I'm just sticking with my guru for the rest of this lifetime. That's all. And my guru has it, my insecurity in total remission. Okay? But I'm going to stick with my guru for this lifetime. That's it. I'm not going to try and leap any higher than that. So I'm still this, down the path, so to speak, down the path with insecurity totally in remission. But part of my dharma is to just stick with it the rest of my life. That's part of the practice here. It's part of the practice. That's what got me to remission in the first place, is saying that that's all that I want. That is the remission. We know the wow is sum total of everything we possibly do. So, going beyond total remission, what does that do? the wow. And denying the wow in this world is a very dangerous thing to do. I don't recommend anybody do that. That's why the lamas, they're still practicing. You know, they say, I'm sticking with my discipline, I'm sticking with everything. Setting a good example. Let's just say only the Dharma kings are beyond the wow. Okay? Only the Dharma kings. And I'm my goal is not to be a Dharma king this life. It is not. That's ruled out. Ruled out. So rule, commit to the wow, rule out being a Dharma king, be a Dharma prince. Okay? So insecurity is a total remission. But I'm ruling out further than that for this life. Maybe further on down the road, you know, so and so. This protects you from those manipulative guru types. It protects you from that. Stay humble. Stay humble. They say, you want to be greater than me? Fine. I don't care. I've already ruled out being a Dharma king, intentionally ruled it out. So I'm not trying to be that. So fight. If you want to be greater than me, wonderful. It doesn't, I'm not going to change what I do the slightest bit. You know, I'm not in competition with anyone anyway. I've already set my parameters, and I'm sticking with it. And I'll get there, you know. For sure I'll get there down the road. So, you know, if you want to feel greater than me, fine. I don't care one way or the other. I'll get there. I'll get to where I'm going eventually. And this is, you're just simply being super wise about the whole thing, right? And while we find advice of Dharma kings here, so to try to go beyond that to being a Dharma king is not following the advice of the Dharma king. You don't get to be a Dharma king by not following the advice of Dharma kings. And you will get there by following the advice of Dharma kings. So they're saying, rule it out for this lifetime. Rule it out. Rule it out. Just remission. Remission's good. No total cure. Just perfect remission. And when you lose interest in even total remission, when you even lose interest in any of that altogether, but that's down the road, beyond this lifetime, okay? So, here we go. We've got it all, don't we? What do we have? We have 471 gig 257, and it's taped flawlessly. So what a great move this was. What a great move this was. I mean, I'm making great moves right now. Super important stuff, and it's just this clicks in, this clicks in, this clicks in. Wonderful. Very basic, very simple stuff. Just engage your core. And engaging our spiritual core is this practice. We set parameters. Which means the only highest we can go is total remission and security. But we can make that. And we have the one practice, the one perfect practice, which is full stop in the wow, which will bring us to total remission of insecurity. So we have the one treasure and the one goal already set, committed to it. That's apex yoga right there, isn't it? The two sides make this apex and apex. We have the total perfect treasure and the perfect goal already right there. We'll just sit in that apexness. It's apex yoga. Say, wow, I'm an apex wow yogin. Wow. And we are. That's an apex yogin right there. Wow. Set the parameters. No Dharma king, just a Dharma prince. Perfect remission of insecurity, but not the total absence, you know, the beyond that. Not beyond that, just perfect remission. And we're not even going to say what's beyond that because it can't be spoken of in a meaningful way. And that's one side. The other side is the perfect practice of wow, the perfect treasure that we have. Perfect treasure, it's both perfect practice and perfect treasure, but that's the other side of the A, and we're in the middle of it, of that A, the apex, apex yoga. Perfect practice, perfect goal, and perfect practicer, right? I mean, just the right practice, the right goal, and the dedication. The third part of like a triangle is the dedication. The faith and dedication. The commitment is actually the third part. So I have the commitment, I have the perfect practice, and I have the perfect goal. There you go. Very stable. Very stable. We've hit 3 hours. Hallelujah. Wow. Imaho. Wow, 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 wow. Surf's up. So, welcome to Surfing the Apocalypse. Welcome to Apex Wow Yoga. It's all great. It's all great. And we will end this now on the note of wow, 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 wow. And even more, right? Even more.